Everyone, Ernakulam branch of SIRC of ICAI welcomes to another virtual CPE seminar on international taxation, overview and treaty discussions. And we have our faculty for this morning, CA Parameswaran ER from Chennai joining us on online. May I request our chairman, CA Ranjit R. Varya, to welcome our speaker and all the delegates.
Very, very good morning to my most respected participants, or I should say a very happy morning to the most respected participants, the learned faculty for this fine Saturday morning, and my most respected eminent managing committee colleagues, welcoming each one of you to this session on international taxation. As probably all of us would have got to know about the great, or rather the very happy news that Ernakulam branch has finally come together to acquire a bigger premise for our Ernakulam branch. I'm sure you would have noticed the email and the mass circulation by WhatsApp and other medias. So it is indeed a great moment of happiness for all of us at the managing committee, where we were rightly led or guided by our very honorable council members, CA Babu Abraham Kallivail sir and regional council member, along with my strong pillars of support in the managing committee, all of them. So indeed a happy moment. We will probably have a brief celebration or so in the coming days ahead. So today we have on this fine topic of international taxation, Parameswaran ER, who though is currently settled and is from Chennai, who's leading a great service in Chennai for a corporate. He is basically a Kochi Karan, if I can say. He's born and brought up in Kochi. A very, very childhood, somebody whom I've been knowing, and we went to Chinmaya school together from childhood days, and is also a second generation chartered accountant. So at the outset, let me take this good opportunity to welcome wholeheartedly Parameswaran ER to this session today. As Ernakulam branch this year and in the past years, we have been trying very hard, and we have been trying to promote a lot of the junior speakers, and very, very learned junior speakers, if I can say. I think this year already we have crossed some 10 or 12 new speakers. We've given opportunity to new speakers to present papers and topics. I also request among the participants, if anybody would like to share a good topic or so for the good interest of our members, we'd be very, very happy to welcome you, and we'd also give you an opportunity to talk to our very good participants from the Ernakulam branch. So with these little words, let me wholeheartedly welcome our dearest participants today for this great session today on this Saturday morning. I should also welcome my esteemed managing committee colleagues, Vice Chairman of the branch, CA Jose KV sir, immediate past chairman Roy Varghese sir, and CA Salim sir, SICASA chairman, wholeheartedly welcoming all of you to this session today. Let's again have a great Saturday learning time ahead. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chairman CA Ranjit R. Varya. I'm very happy and privileged to introduce our speaker for this morning, CA Parameswaran ER. He's with more than 9 years experience in corporate and international taxation. In his earlier stint at Deloitte and BMR Advisors, CA Parameswaran has worked closely with a range of clientele consisting of individuals, firms, multinational corporations, and Indian groups in addressing their tax advisory, reporting, and litigation requirements. Apart from tax, his area of expertise spans transfer pricing, personal tax, exchange control, and other regulations. He has worked with clients ranging across industries such as IT, oil and gas, real estate, technology and communications, banking and financial services, and business process outsourcing, etc. CA Parameswaran is now head of tax of Servion Global Solutions Limited, and is responsible for handling tax compliance and litigations of the company in 9 jurisdictions. With these words, I introduce and welcome CA Parameswaran to commence the session. Over to you, Parameshan sir.
Thank you, Ranjit. Thank you, Joe sir. Thank you, Ranjit, for that nostalgia trip. Yes, it is right. I have spoken at a few forums. I've spoken at our Chennai Institute here. I've spoken in Kerala. The chapter is also Calicut, in Bangalore also. But it is always a different feeling when you speak at your home institute. So as a student, I've been there a lot of times. Till I was in Cochin, I used to be active in attending sessions while I haven't spoken there. So yes, it is always a pleasure. Thank you, Ranjit, for extending this invitation to speak at Cochin chapter. Thank you, Joseph, for that wonderful introduction. So respected members, all the participants, thank you. First of all, I hope you're all safe. I hope you're all wherever you are, I hope you're all safe, and because of these trying circumstances, conditions, safety is a relative term, but I wish you all the best. Now, I've been told to speak on international tax. So international tax, the apart from, if you look at typical subjects of which what we speak, even if it is tax or non-tax subjects, there would be some connection with what we have learned, or we would have heard, or we would have kind of at least had a theoretical or an overview of what the topic is. Now, people, most of us, I believe, whoever who have cleared their CA, let's say pre-2017, international tax was never there in our syllabus actually. It was there as a passing mention. It was there. I would not say it was not there. It was there as a passing mention. But that passing mention, frankly, didn't do justice to the vastness of that topic, to the length and breadth of that entire topic. Therefore, for most of us, the exposure to international tax came from practical experience. People like me, who didn't have a theoretical knowledge prior to clearing CA, post-clearing CA, had to get into issues, had to read, had to experience client queries, had to experience client litigation, and start knowing on the flavor of international tax. But I think now the circumstances have entirely changed. I think it is a very well decision, very good decision of the institute to put international tax as an elective paper in our final syllabus. Whether or not people specialize in it or not, or they elect it or not, or at least even if they, after electing, they apply it in their practical practice or whatever, wherever their career takes them, it is always, people who have read it would appreciate the vastness of that subject. So I think the institute has the right track, and the materials which they provide in that regard is also like top notch. In fact, one of those materials and all, I have had the, before it was printed and all, I had the opportunity to see that, because they usually collect, I think the institute collects representation from a lot of people within practice, and then we had contributed to that. Now, coming back to this topic of international tax, before I go into the length and before I go into international tax and all its vagaries, I just want to first focus on the second word, which is tax, because ultimately we are talking about tax here. While it is all international and cross-border, we are the core focus point is on the term tax. Now, tax essentially is a payment for any SSE. Let's say, let it be an individual, or let it be a company, or let it be a partnership firm. It is essentially a payment. It is always a liability to pay for an SSE. Now, it is a liability to pay for us. Okay, right. But it is a revenue for the government. It is a revenue to the department to whom we pay. Very basic, nothing new here. Everybody knows about all these concepts. So tax basically is a revenue for the government. And any government, just like any individual or any company or anything, would like to see their income side increase for whatever be the reasons. For us, it is to meet our daily essentials, to grow, etc., to create wealth and all. But for the government, the purpose of increasing the share of taxes in their income is to meet welfare expenditures. So what we contribute as tax is supposedly should come back to us in the form of welfare expenditure, like infrastructure, public services, etc., etc. Now, so when a government looks at tax, and they want to increase the income which they get from tax, or in other words, they want to shore up their tax revenue, there are different ways to do that. Typically, there are two ways. One, you increase the tax rate. It's very simple. If your corporate tax rate is 25% or 30%, you increase it to 40%. Of course, people who are supposed to pay corporate taxes, earlier, let's say 1 lakh profit, you used to pay 30,000. You will now pay 40,000. So that is one mechanism of increasing taxes, which is to increase the rates. The second way is to increase the shore up the tax base. That means bring in, without doing an increase in your tax rates or without doing any juggling on the tax numbers, let's increase the tax base. Let's increase the number of assessees within the purview who pay taxes. So that is the second option for any government. Now, the issue with the first option is it's an investor sentiment. It is for, so let's see, if somebody like me, let's not go into corporate or internet, let's somebody like me who's a salary earner. If I already pay taxes based on my slab rates, now any increase in a tax rate for me is always a sensitive issue. This is also applicable to a business. This is applicable to a firm. This is applicable to any SS. Any increase in a tax rate is always a sensitive issue. So the government would ideally think twice before they want to increase a tax rate. So then what is the other mechanism? Because it's a sensitive issue, the difficulty to get to convince why the tax rate needs to be increased. The other option is to increase the tax user base. Now that means, like, for example, let's look at domestic scenario. For example, there are tax exempt income. Let's say dividend income was earlier not taxed. So let's say an SSE who used to earn only dividend income. There are people in the north who just live by share dividends, dividend they receive from the investment. They never used to pay taxes. But that has changed now. Earlier the tax was paid by the company in the form of DDT. 2 years back or a year back, they amended 1034. They amended to say no more dividend is no more exempted. You have to pay tax. So what happened? They never increased any tax rates there. They just shored up the tax base. They just bought more SSEs within the purview of tax. Or let's say an agricultural income is now tax free. So tomorrow, while it is a very sensitive topic now, tomorrow if they want to suddenly increase the tax base, rather than increasing the tax rate, they'll just make agricultural income taxable. So that means they are increasing the tax, and thereby they are trying to increase the revenue or shore up the tax revenue. Now all that is fine. This is the basic of any tax. Any country, this is not only in India, any country, any government would like to increase its tax revenue, and they try to brainstorm, and they try to bring up ideas as to how to do that without making it a very sensitive matter. Now let's take our country, India. In India, taxes are two forms: direct tax, indirect tax. Now, indirect tax is a purview of both the state and the center. But direct tax is only the purview of the center. So tomorrow, Pinarayi Vijayan or N.K. Stalin cannot wake up and suddenly realize that their fiscal deficit is very wide. So, oh my God, I want a new tax revenue. I want a new revenue. Shall I start levying taxes on their income? Can a chief minister of a state do that? No, they cannot do that, because the power to collect income taxes is coming in the union list, 246. So the union list will give the power, has delegated the power to the parliament to frame laws and collect taxes on income. This is all not new information. These are just basics. So now that it is settled that the mechanism to collect taxes, we all know that the mechanism of to collect taxes rests with the center only. So what they did was in the 1920s, there was an act. Then after that, they amended it and they brought the 1961 Income Tax Act. It was passed in the parliament. It applies to the whole of India. So wherever there is an SSE, I am sitting in Chennai, you are sitting in Cochin. You make a payment to me. Suppose you make a payment to me. What will you do? when you make the payment, you will look at what is a, you will look at automatically, you will look at your TDS provisions under 194J or whatever, 194I or whatever is the section. You will see whether TDS is deductible. You deduct TDS if it is applicable. From your side, you file, you collect my PAN, you file my TDS return. That is your obligation is over. What is my obligation? I look at my, I have to declare, I file my return of income at the end of the year. I disclose my income. I pay, take credit of the taxes which you have filed, which is the tax which I've already paid in the form of TDS, and I pay and I close my return of income. And if I get a refund, I'll get a refund. Now, all this, whatever I just explained now, is something which comes within the borders of my Income Tax Act. Everything is, whatever I said now about TDS, about income, about filing return, is something which is coming within the four corners of my Income Tax Act 1961. I look at my, what do I do? Because it is an India related transaction. There is no Kerala, there is no Tamil Nadu, there is no Karnataka here. It's all India. Everything happens, everything, we only look at it at a central level. I look at my TDS provision, I file my return within the due date. Everything is processed within the contours of my Income Tax Act. Very easy. If there is tomorrow, there is a litigation which comes tomorrow, I have a disallowance, my assessing officer made a disallowance in my return of income, or while processing an intimation, something happened, some disallowance. What do? I go into appeal. I go into appeal, I file an appeal, or I file a rectification. Or if that doesn't work out, I file an appeal. I go to my CITA. So all these provisions are all coded within my Income Tax Act. And everything is settled within the contours of Income Tax Act. We don't have an issue there. That is not what we are trying to discuss. That is one scenario. Now let's come to the other scenario. Let's say that there is a company in US. Okay, so this is an example which I've given earlier also, but I think this is a very localized example, and it covers a lot of issues within that. So let's look at Kochiyile Puthuvaippinte terminal. That LNG terminal which appears in all the movies and all. So Petronet, owned and operated by Petronet. So what Petronet did was that they came, they saw that Cochin is a good place to, because of its locational advantage, they saw that this particular area is good, is an apt place to, you know, fill, to construct their container storage terminal to collect natural gas, which can be used as a feeder to for requirement for power for industries along the northern belt, which goes up to Bangalore. So for, they found out Cochin is the apt place. Petronet found that. Now they have to build the LNG terminal, right? They have to build that container. Now Petronet, what they did was that they went to, let's say they approached a US entity. Let's call it A Inc. So they approach the US entity and they say, this is what we want you to do. This is where we want the container terminal to come. Can you do it? Yeah, sure. They said, what they did, they traveled here. They saw the place. They looked at the plans. They gave the plans. They did a lot of services and then they went back. Or they just came and looked and they went back. And then they went back to US. Now, after they went back to US, based on the agreed terms of it, they raised an invoice. Let's say it's $100,000. Now the invoice came to me. I am Petronet. I look at the invoice. Now what I am going to do is, I look at section 195, because section 195 is the section which talks about withholding tax for non-resident payments. A incorporated is a non-resident, so I have to look at section 195. So section 195 will say, whenever I make a payment, I should deduct taxes. It's onto a non-resident, etc., etc. Is this a payment on which, so let's assume that services were in the nature of fee for technical services. Is this a payment which comes within the, is the nature of the contract in a manner, it's drafted in a manner that it comes within the purview of fee for technical services under the Act, section 91 explanation, I think 6 or 7. 917 explanation, whether it comes within the definition of FTS under the Act. Yes, it is coming. I'm from Petronet. Okay, I am the tax guy in Petronet. I say yes, it is. Where is the rate given? I go and check section 115A. Section 115A will give me my rate. Let's say it's 10%. Now what I say is, I call up the Petronet guy. I tell him, see, you have raised a bill for $100,000. Now under my India, under my Act, my India Income Tax Act, I'm in India, by the way. So I have to follow my income tax act. I'm going to give you the payment. There is no, don't worry. I'm going to give you a payment, but I'm not going to give you $100,000. I'll give you $90,000. You're going to get $90,000. $10,000, I will deduct. 10% I'm going to deduct. So $10,000 I'm going to deduct. I will file my, you don't worry, I will file 26Q or 27Q or whatever TDS, and then you will can claim or not. So the Petronet guy will come back and say, okay, sure, your domestic act will have all those provisions, Frank. But you have to first understand that I am not an Indian entity. I'm a US entity. So for a US entity like me, why are you saying that you should look at the Income Tax Act? I am a resident of, let's say, New York. My entity is in New York. According to my income tax, according to the federal taxes, according to IRS in US, this is something which does not need to suffer withholding tax. Anyway, it is going to be my business income. I'm going to pay profits in taxes on my profits in US. So you don't have to deduct taxes in under my act, under the IRS, under the codes which are laid down by the IRS. There is no obligation to for me to suffer this withholding tax. So that is not possible. So they will come back to Petronet and say that is not possible. Why are they saying that it is not possible? It is not only because of withholding. It is because it is a cost. We have agreed with them for $100,000. They are only going to get $90,000. $10,000 is less when they get it. Now they don't know whether they'll get credit of that in India. They'll have to run behind to get the $10,000. So ultimately, what will happen to the business? It is a cost to them. That is on one side. So as a businessman, I'm worried about my cost. I'm worried about my tax cost because it will ultimately hit my profits. It will ultimately hit my cash flows. Now, as an SSE who's supposed to pay under the Income Tax Act, Petronet, from my side, I can also say whatever you say does not apply to me. Your IRS, your act applies to you, just like how your act applies to you, my act applies to me. So I am supposed to do this. I don't care. Is that the dispute? Now, these are cross-border disputes. Now, this is a typical example of a cross-border issue. This is a typical example of how to settle a tax, how to settle a cross-border taxation related issue. And that is where a treaty comes into the play. So while I am right to look at the Income Tax Act, I am not fully right. While A Incorporated is right to say that if there is no obligation under his domestic laws, he is also not right to, he is not fully correct, because India and US has signed a treaty. India will say, so why is India saying it is a foreign income? Ultimately, the US resident is right. He has to bear the cost burden. And the India entity is like saying that it's okay, the source is in. So you may say that, but it's a source based taxation. So then I have to pay taxes. Now, these disputes arise primarily because different countries in the world follow their own system of taxation. It is not, taxation is not a standardized subject across jurisdictions. What I follow in India is not the taxation system in US. What is in US is not what is followed in Singapore. What is in Singapore is not what is followed in UK. Each country, depending on its macroeconomic conditions and microeconomic conditions to shore up their tax revenue, will follow its own taxation system. Let's take our income tax. So there are primarily two types of taxation systems. One is residence-based tax, second is source-based tax. Under residence-based tax, you look at the residential status of the SSE and then you determine the taxation of the income. Under the source-based law, you look at the source of income, from where the income is arising, and then determine the taxability. Now, India follows a mix of source, residence, and source base. So for all taxation related purposes, for all determining whether an SSE is chargeable to tax or not, they look at the source of taxation. Everything is codified under section 6, 7, 8, 9 and all. If I am an individual, all the residential status will apply. If I am a company, I should be incorporated in India, and the place of effective management, POEM, which I'll come to him later, should be in India. If I am a firm, partnership act. That is how India determines its residential status. But that is one side. But there is a source-based taxation also. Section 9 is talking about source. So wherever there is a non-resident whose source of income is in India, then for that, residence doesn't apply. Because A Incorporated is ultimately not a resident of India. It is in US. But still, you have to go and look at section 9, because section 9 will say all these payments which you make to a non-resident does not depend on residence, it depends on the source. Suppose you sell shares in a foreign country, why is it taxed in India? It's because it is when you sell shares, why is it taxed in India? When, if there is a business connection, why is it taxed in India? If you make royalty payment, if you make FTS payment, this foreign income, foreign corporation is not a resident of India, but still we are liable to, but still we have to look at section 9. Why? Because for those sections, it is source-based taxation. That is one system. Then there is the US, then there is a worldwide system. So systems of taxation are basically divided into source base and residence base. Then there is something called as a worldwide taxation system where global income is taxed. Where so US follows what is known as a worldwide system. It has a, so US is an economy, which is a very developed economy. No, everybody knows that. It is an economy which has a lot of power in the world. It is such, it's called as a developed economy. It is called as a it's called a lot of names in as far as their power, you should say, to negotiate is concerned, is because US is the place where most of the businesses come from. You look at your Apple, you look at the laptop which you are using, you look at the Cisco WebEx which we are currently, it's all US. So a lot of transactions, so because that economy has matured over the past 200 years, their taxation system is very evolved. So they follow something known as the worldwide system of taxation. Now these tax issues, why? Because there is taxation among countries are not standardized, as I said before, because India follows its own taxation system. No country follows an India taxation system. Similarly, India doesn't follow any other country's taxation system. No country can follow, customize their taxation system based on other country, because as I said earlier, it depends on the macro and microeconomic conditions. Now, what happens is whenever there is a cross-border related transaction, you cannot simply rely on your domestic act, because the domestic act is drafted in a manner where our country wants to shore up its tax revenues. Very good. We have to shore up its tax revenue. We need income from wherever we can. Very good. But again, it is something which is a sensitive issue. It is a sentimental issue. For a foreign company, they will first, whenever they want to invest in India, they will look at the taxation system. They will see how the tax system is structured in India, and then accordingly they will take calls, because they don't want to have additional tax liability in a country just because the country is laid out in a manner. They look at whether there is treaty signed. If there is no treaties, they suddenly look, why haven't you signed a treaty with my country? Now that is where treaties come into play. So let's take the Petronet example. As I said earlier, I am looking at section 90. Petronet is saying under the domestic act, you cannot. Now, how do we settle this? Now, again, coming back to my earlier introduction, the power to collect tax lies with the union. That means the central government, whichever government is at the center, is delegated the power to collect taxes on income. From wherever, from our SSEs, from resident SSEs, from non-resident SSEs, everywhere. So that is the power granted by the Constitution. Okay, that is fine. Now, why should we even look at a treaty? Now, okay, so now we know there is a tax treaty. Tax treaties are usually signed by two governments who sit. It will have a lot of articles, it will have lot of taxes, and basically in that tax treaties, they basically agree, two countries basically agree how they will share their taxes, which country has the right to tax what source of income. If it is royalty, how do you tax? If it is business profits, how do you tax? If it is dividend, how do you tax? If it is capital gain, who has the right to tax? Basically, a tax treaty is a document where two countries, diplomats of two countries, they sit down over the table, they look at all possible sources of income, and then they agree, and then they decide, okay, this is what you tax, this US, you, if something happens in India, you have the right. If something happens, there is a transaction in the US, I have, India has the right. They agree there. That is what basically a tax treaty wants to do. How was the tax treaty? Now, if you have seen a tax treaty, you will see that there are a lot of articles in that. Article 1, 2, 3, 4, it goes up to 26, 27. Below that, there are protocols. Below that, there are other signing signatories who refer to a lot of conventions, and then they give out their commentary and all. Now, a tax treaty is basically, as I said earlier, tax treaty is basically signed to settle cross-border tax disputes. Very simple. Now, the fundamental base for creating a tax treaty is there are two, three structures, formats which are there. So one is known as the OECD format. OECD is nothing but Organization of Economic Development Cooperation. They have given out a structure. So they have seen, so earlier OECD was formed with a lot of developed economies. So they had a lot of cross-border payments. And then they sat down and they created a structure of how a treaty should be. And that treaty, that structure is basically taken by countries. And then they customize it. They agree. They will say, this is you, okay, you tax this income, but this tax income I will tax. This, let's split this income between us. You have a part right, I have a part right. Now, if some tax is deducted in that jurisdiction, let me take credit, let me take off. Also, all these are codified in a tax treaty. So by merely looking at a domestic tax act, you cannot settle a cross-border payment. You are obligated to go and check your tax treaty. Now I'm saying you are obligated. Who is giving me an obligation? Then the next question will come. Okay, fine, Parameshwaran. You are saying I should not look. You are saying I agree that it is a domestic act. The scope is very restrictive. It only applies across India. The first term in my income tax act will actually apply only across India. It will not say it will apply in US or in apply in Singapore. It will say it apply in India. Okay, I agree. You are saying it will not apply for a cross-border payment. Okay, now you tell me, why should I even go and look at a treaty? Where is that sanction? Then obviously that is the next question. So allow me to do I have sharing rights? Can you give me sharing rights, please?
Yes, Raju.
Thank you. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
So this is a website which most of you would be familiar with. This is the Income Tax Department website. Okay, now I have been telling so far that what a tax treaty is, why should we even go for a tax treaty? What is the need for look? What is why you agree to some extent that we have to look at you? I cannot settle a cross-border payment by merely looking at the Income Tax Act. I should not. Why then do you expect me to go and read the IRS or the Singapore Tax Act or the UK Tax Act? No, I cannot do all that. So what are you asking me to do? You are asking me to read the treaty. Fine, I'll read the treaty. But tell me, why should I even read the treaty? Shouldn't there be a provision which says I should go and access the treaty? A very true question, a very relevant question. That is where Section 90 comes into play. So that is what Section 90. So unlike Section, let's say 79, you know what Section 79 is, right? Section 79 starts with a non-obstante clause. It says that wherever there is a change in shareholding of more than 50%, 51%, you cannot carry forward the losses. You cannot care if the shareholding is more than 50%, you cannot carry forward the losses and set. You can carry forward, but you cannot set it off with the future. That's it. Now, if you look at Section 79, it starts with the term notwithstanding anything contained in any other provisions. That means it's a non-obstante clause. It starts with the term notwithstanding anything contained in any other provisions. That means all the other provisions, whatever you are referring to in terms of a particular transaction, is now redundant because Section 79 will supersede. But here it doesn't start with the non-obstante clause. It will say, Section 90 will say, the central government may enter into an agreement. So the parliament, so the union list constitution, entry 14 of the union list will say, the power to collect taxes lies with the parliament. The parliament is basically the central government. So the parliament, the constitution has delegated the right to the central government. So that is why it says the central government. Most provisions don't start with this language, but this provision starts with starts with this language, because it is very clear that no person other than the central government has the power to enter into an agreement with a foreign country. So the central government may enter into an agreement with the government of any country outside India or specified territory outside India for granting relief in respect of income on which taxes have been paid. So for granting relief, it's a relief which is granted. It's a cross-border payment. My example in Petronet is a cross-border payment where a foreign party or me, both cases, is expecting a relief, is expecting some sort of relief from the existing tax position, which I'm saying that it is $10,000. They were, so as per my act, it is very clear and I'm fully right. But then what is there a relief which can be provided in this case? So that is what it says, for granting of, for the granting of relief in respect of income on which have been paid both income tax under this act and income tax in that country for specified territory as a scheme, income chargeable under this act and under corresponding law in force of that country or specified territory as the case may be, to promote mutual economic relations, etc., etc., for avoidance of double taxation of income under this act and under the corresponding law in force of that country or specified territory. So again, very relevant, why are we looking at a treaty? First is to grant relief. You have to grant relief in respect of taxes paid or chargeability of income. Then the second objective is to avoid double taxation of an income. Now why, let's pause the Petronet example. Let's look at us as individuals. Okay, let me give you an example, which so let's say I am an individual, I have some surplus money. Okay, I have done some good savings and I have got some surplus money. Now I want to grow my, I want to create some wealth. Now I have a lot of means. I can go and invest in, buy land, or I can go and invest in shares, but I am a bit more entrepreneurial. What I'm going to do is, I find that, so there is a Chennai company, and this is our actual example. There is a Chennai company which is called Freshworks. So Freshworks is going to do an IPO. And that IPO is not in India, and that IPO is going to be in NASDAQ. It's in US. So they're going to list, an Indian company, an Indian entity is going to list their shares in US. So the Indian entity will not be listing. There will be a US entity for that. There will be a US company in, for that entity, and they are going to list their shares in NASDAQ. Now, what I'm going to do is, I want to, so now today there are platforms where you can go and invest in shares outside India, right? It's all that is very easy now. So I'm going to say, I'm going to invest in that IPO. Okay, fine. I invested in that IPO also. So when you invest in shares, there are two ways I get an income. One is dividend. I earn dividend income from that shares. That company declares dividend. I am the shareholder. I get dividend. Second is the capital gain. Now let's leave the capital gain discussion. Let's leave capital gain. I'll come. Let's say dividend. So suppose Freshworks declared, I should subscribe to the IPO. I got shares allotted. 1 year later, they did extremely well, and I got some dividend. Now, where does it, this is an entity which is listed in NASDAQ, by the way, it is not in India. So this dividend is in US dollars. I will get the dividend in my US bank account. There will be a US bank account for me, and that dividend, I will have to take it from my US bank account and get it to India. Now, my income tax India obligation is very clear. I have to declare this income in India. There is no doubt there. I am a resident in India. I am taxed as per the residency concept. Therefore, I am a resident and ordinarily resident. My global income is taxable. So whatever I earn out of dividend from which is issued by, which is declared by Freshworks, I'm going to tax it in India. And the income taxes, whatever, my slab rates or whatever. But US also, the income is, where is the income first reaching? It reaches US. So US will obviously have a tax there, right? So the same income is going to be taxed there, and after coming to India, it is going to be taxed here also. Now, well, one point is, why do you want to go and, you know, that is not the discussion we are planning to have. We are planning to have a discussion where I got some dividend in US. It is taxed there and it is taxed here. What do I do? I have to go and claim credit of the taxation, because my US treaty will say I can take a credit of taxes in India. There is rule 128, which I'll come to it later, and I do that. So my point is on this, for the avoidance of double taxation of income under this act. That is one side. But what about double non-taxation? That is the other side. So this act, this provision was only said earlier for the avoidance of double taxation of income under this act and the corresponding law in force. This year it got amended to say, to extend it to say, without creating opportunities for non-taxation or reduced taxation through tax avoidance or evasion. So the general colors through treaty shopping arrangements aimed at obtaining release in respect of the said agreement for indirect transfer benefit of residence, blah, blah, blah. So one objective of treaty, which is right, is that it, there should be double, there should not be a double taxation of an income. But the other objective of a treaty is that there should also be double non-taxation. There shouldn't be a double non-taxation. That means I should, it should not be a system where I invest in shares of some company. I sell the share outside India. I sell the shares there. I get, as per the treaty, India doesn't have the right to tax. So in my case also, so even if I bring that same income to India, it will not get taxed. Because if you look at the earlier Mauritius treaty or the Singapore treaty before 2017, which I'll again show now, it used to say, income from a contracting state will be taxed where it arises. That means if I pre-2017, if there is more, if I hold shares in Mauritius, Mauritius and India has agreed in the treaty that India will not tax. That capital gain is not taxable in India. Even though our domestic law has respective provisions to tax in India. My India Income Tax Act is very clear. Any shares which I sell is capital gain. But if it is a shares which is located in Mauritius or even in Singapore, there is no right to tax it. There is no need to tax it. So that means India has ceded the right to Mauritius to tax it. That means Mauritius can tax it. India cannot tax it. Now, what will happen if Mauritius is saying, okay, I don't want capital gain tax. Under their domestic law, Mauritius is saying there is no capital gains chapter even. They are saying, I don't want to tax share income. I am okay. Government, Mauritius government is saying, you come and invest here. You keep on, let companies come and invest here. You let businesses grow here. You can sell shares here. I don't want your capital gain tax. I want taxes on your profits, on salaries and whatever, house properties and all. But I don't want capital gains. If that is the case, what will you do? That is where, that is known as treaty shopping. Or let's take another example. That is an example of treaty shopping where I go and invest shares. I go and incorporate shares in a company in Mauritius, invest it, bring the funds through Mauritius to India. Now it is not possible, but earlier it was possible to bring shares, funds through Mauritius, invest in an Indian company shares in Mauritius. I will not sell shares of the India entity. I will sell shares of the Mauritius entity. And Mauritius will say, I don't have capital gain tax. India will say, India, the treaty is very clear. India has given the right to Mauritius to tax sale of shares. So that was known as treaty shopping. So there was a lot of issue around treaty shopping. And that is why there was something called BEPS action plan, which again I'll discuss. So my point is on the clause B, which says the objective of a treaty should not only be double non-taxation, but it should also avoid double non-taxation. Then the third objective of any treaty is for exchange of information for prevention of evasion or avoidance of income tax, etc. That means both countries, whenever there is a treaty, every treaty will have a clause where, let's say Switzerland, you know that everybody will say Switzerland on a black money park is Switzerland on a black money park. Why is because their privacy laws are very, very, their privacy laws are very, very stringent. They have their internal laws where you cannot disclose account names, etc., etc. But subsequently, you cannot, it's all Indian. So India will say, so as I said earlier, India will look at shoring up its tax revenue, right? So without increasing the tax rate. So then they will say, see, all high HNIs, high net worth individuals, their money is sitting in Switzerland. I don't have visibility because the Switzerland domestic law is very strict. Now that is not possible. I want exchange of information. You should exchange the information which you have with me, and you also have the right to ask me information of any income where it is in India which you feel should be taxed there. You have the right. It should be mutual. That power is given in treaties, and that is what Section 90 will also has delegated to the central government. Then the fourth is recovery of income tax under this act or any corresponding law in force. So that is something. Like, let's talk about the Cairn example. I don't know whether you have seen the news recently where the concept of indirect tax transfer 1 month back, think less than a month back, government came out with a notification which said indirect transfers will only apply prospectively, no more retrospective. So why that happened? Because of the CAN issue, CAIR. What happened? Okay, I'll come to the CAN issue later. But then CAN finally, we levied taxes, we levied a demand on to CAIR in UK. CAN went and appealed. They won it. They lost in India. Then they appealed to they went to the International Court of Justice. There they won, and then they said whatever taxes. So India had collected some taxes from CAN. CAN said you have to give it back to me. So India was looking at how to avoid all this without giving anything. So they said we'll give you one oil block. We'll give you one oil block there. No. CAN said no. They are into oil refining. So I don't want your oil block there. I want this asset which you have in US. This asset which have in. So these are recovery mechanisms which CAN initiated from UK to recover taxes which India government collected very long back. So that the same right is given to India also to collect taxes from where they have the right to recover taxes from any SSE which is located outside India. So that is the fourth clause. Now this is all about treaty. There is a law which is given in Income Tax Act on royalty or whatever. I come to a position. Let's take the Petronet example itself. I say it is taxable under the Income Tax Act. I look at the treaty, India-US treaty. Okay, I find that the treaty landing privilege is very different. And I declare and I say, okay, under the treaty, it is not taxable. Now I agree. Under the treaty is not taxable. Now the question is, what should I do? I have two tax positions before me. One under my domestic act. I am Petronet, by the way. I have one under the domestic act, which will say it is taxable. The other, which is also a right position, which under the treaty, which will say it is not taxable. Now as watch, which position should I take? So that is what subclause 2 says, where the central government has entered into any agreement with the government of any country outside India or specified territory outside India, as the case may be, under subsection 1 for granting relief of taxes or as the case may be, avoidance of double taxation, then in relation to the SSE to whom such agreement applies, the provisions of this act shall apply to the extent they are more beneficial to the SSE. So which is beneficial to SSE? Obviously the benefit is under the treaty, because I find that under, as per the treaty, I read the treaty and I saw that the definition is different in the US treaty. So therefore I can go and say there is no requirement to withhold any $10,000. I can fully remit the $100,000 without deducting taxes. Which should I opt? Whichever is more beneficial. Which is more beneficial? $100,000. So then I decide, fine. I go and so in a real life practical scenario, these are the challenges which happens. How is a cross-border payment? Where is the cross-border payment arising? Where is the source of the payment? What is the residential status of the SSEs involved in the particular transaction? And what is the position which I should finally adopt based on my reading of the treaty? My act itself is giving me the right to adopt whichever is more beneficial. It should be read in a treaty should be read in a very holistic manner. You should have a bird's eye view. And then you should look at what the language of the treaty is saying and then read it. Now, I'm talking about reading treaty and all. Now, how do you read a treaty? So there are two ways to read a treaty. One is known as the first. There are two approaches. One is the static approach and second is called as the ambulatory approach. So how you read a treaty will depend on which approach you are following. So what the static approach says is that suppose I enter into an agreement, let's say with the United Kingdom. Okay. And let me open the UK treaty. So I have entered into an agreement with the United Kingdom. Okay. When did I enter into this agreement? Let's say, let's say it is in 1993. Okay, 1993. There is something in 1993. I got by OTP notification. This is notified. So this UK treaty was notified somewhere in 94. It was notified in 1994. So it applies from 1994-1995 onwards. Now there is a domestic law. Income Tax Act is from 1961. So it existed in 94 and 95 also. Now there was a law which was existing when the treaty was signed in 94-95. Okay. Should you read the treaty with the law which existed in 1994 today, or should you read a treaty which was signed in 1994 with a law which exists today? So these are the two approaches in interpreting a treaty. The first approach, where the treaty is read with respect to the law which applied in 1994, is known as the static approach. Why is that relevant? Is because both parties would have sat down, diplomats of both countries would have sat down over the table, and they would have looked at the section in 1994. They can't predict the law which is there in 2021, right? They can only go by whatever is the law at that point of time. So in 1994, this was the law, and therefore we have discussed and we have agreed on taxing right between us. So the question then is, when you read a treaty, should you look at the act at the time when the treaty was entered into, which is 1994, or should you look at the treaty in 1994 read with the act in 2021? The first approach is known as the static approach. The second approach is known as the ambulatory approach. Now, in general treaty interpretations, no, we don't follow a static approach. We only follow the ambulatory approach. Now, to explain what is a static approach and why the what is an ambulatory approach, let's take a case law. Let's take the Vodafone issue itself. Most of you must be familiar with the Vodafone issue. It was in the news in 2011-2012. It is still in the news now. The Cairn example is also an offshoot of the Vodafone ruling. Now, what happened in Vodafone was, there was a structure where Vodafone, there was a UK shareholder. UK shareholder, which had layers, which had a lot of holdings, and it sold some shares of a Singapore entity. A UK resident sold some shares of a Singapore entity to Netherlands. Okay, this is what happened. UK entity sold shares of Singapore entity to Netherlands. Okay, let's assume this has happened, but the point is, it was a non-resident transaction. India is not there in the picture. There is no India shareholder here. What I'm saying is a situation where there is a UK resident, there's a UK entity. UK entity had some investments in Singapore. Singapore entity sold some shares in the event. Now, why should India be there in the picture here? Why should we look at India itself here? So what happened was that the assessing officer at that point of time, when they were going through Vodafone's financials and tax assessments, they found this change. So I'm assuming, this is an assumption which I'm making, but a sharp assessing officer would have seen that in the reporting which they did, this transaction has happened, either in the related party or somewhere this reporting would have happened. Now he went and dug further into the transaction, and he found that there was a layers of entities which were set up. And it is true, the Singapore entity sold shares in India. Nobody's disputing that. But when he went and checked the Singapore entity financials, he saw that while it is a Singapore entity, there is no doubt it is incorporated in Singapore, everything is taxed in Singapore. The value of the Singapore entity, so when UK entity sold shares, they would have assigned the valuation for that company, right? They can't simply sell shares based on looking at the share capital and losses. They would have done a valuation. Now, what the assessing officer at that point of time found out was, the Singapore company had some assets in India, and those assets were responsible for the valuation of the Singapore entity, for the high valuation of Singapore entity. And that is how the shares got sold. Now, so what the assessing officer has said, assessing officer was of the view, okay, fine, this is an agreement, this is a transaction between Singapore and Netherlands, I'm not disputing that. But you look at your Singapore entity, you made a valuation of $1 billion. Your $1 billion is because of assets which are situated in India. Look at the balance sheet which you have given. these assets are responsible for your valuation. So whether, even if you say it is a transaction between non-residents, I am imputing that this is a transaction which this is an indirect transfer of shares. Ideally, you should have shares, sold the shares of the India entity, but instead you went and sold shares of the Singapore entity. You may have sold the shares of the Singapore entity. There is no issues there. I agree with you, but you have indirectly sold the shares of the India entity, because the value of the Singapore entity derived its value substantially from my India entity. Therefore, this is considered as an indirect transfer in India, and therefore this is a capital gains in India, and therefore you are liable to be taxed. This is how the Vodafone issue came. There was no India entity there. There was no treaty. I'll come to the treaty. There was no India in the picture there. But the assessing officer, whoever he was a very sharp guy, and he found this. He made an interpretation like this, and that interpretation never existed. Now there is a provision for indirect transfer which came in 2012. But at that point of time, there was no provision for taxing indirect transfer. Now, if I look at the India, now why am I talking about the indirect transfer provision? Is because if you look at the capital gain section, if you look at the capital gain article, now this is the capital gain article in UK. Except as provided in Article 8 and Article 9 of this convention, each contracting state may tax capital gain in accordance with the provisions of its domestic laws. That means if somebody is, if a UK resident, shares and sells shares of an India company, who was the, in 1995, this was in 1995, mind you, when they entered into an agreement, they ceded the right to India. UK will not tax it. It is according to the domestic law where the shares are, where each contracting state has the freedom to tax it as per the domestic law. So if the UK entity had sold the shares of the India, of an India company, the domestic law applicable is India. Therefore, the taxing right has been given to India, not UK. UK said, I don't want to tax it, you tax it. That is what the domestic law is saying. Domestic law is very clear. We have to tax capital gain on sale of shares. But then UK became in FX. UK became in FX to say that they cannot tax it, but they are given the right for to India to tax it. Now later on, the story doesn't end there. It went up to Supreme Court. This particular capital gain issue went up to Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said, gave a verdict in favor of Vodafone. Okay, Vodafone, it gave a favor in saying that nothing doing. You can say it is all indirect transfer, but basically this is a transaction between two non-resident entities. India doesn't have a taxing right. Okay, this ruling came out somewhere in 2012 budget. Now what happened was that Pranab Mukherjee was the finance minister then. He went and made an amendment in section 9. What he went and said was, this is an amendment and this became a very, very controversial issue. Now section 9(1)(1) deals with income arising from transfer of capital asset. Okay, so following income shall be deemed to accrue or arise in India, where all income accruing or arising, whether directly or indirectly through any form of business connection in India, or from any property in India, or through or from any asset or source of income in India, or through the capital transfer of capital asset situated in India. Okay. Now there was an explanation which he inserted. Okay, this is an amendment which came in 2012. This is post Supreme Court verdict. Okay, Supreme Court gave a verdict in favor of Vodafone. For the removal of doubt, it is hereby clarified that an asset or a capital asset, being any share or interest in a company or entity registered or incorporated outside India, shall be deemed to be and shall always be deemed to have been situated in India, if the share or interest derives directly or indirectly its value substantially from the assets located in India. This is Vodafone. This is indirect transfer. This was not there earlier. Explanation 5 came later. Explanation 5 was not there when the Vodafone addition took place. But later on, what happened was that after the Supreme Court verdict, which went in favor of the SSE, Pranab Mukherjee, the then finance minister, put this section with retrospective applicability, not from 2011 or 10 or 9, from 1961, with retrospective applicability from 1962. So any transfer, the department had the tomorrow suddenly something happened in 1975 also the department could honor that the power was given. Now coming back to my discussion on static and ambulatory approach, assuming this took place, so should you read the provision as per the law which existed in 1995, or then we usually refer, so we look at the ambulatory way of reading a treaty. We say you have to look at the direct tax law which is prevalent at that point of time, and then take. Now you can, now what happened after this, again Vodafone, so whatever the Supreme Court demand, it became nullified. But again they went and then appeal, and then again they associate wanted from Supreme Court. But this was one of the platforms, this was actually called as tax terrorism, this section, and there are subsequent other section where at that point of time the current government, which was in the opposition, they put in doubt in their manifesto that they will end tax terrorism. And the tax terrorism was because of the 2012 amendments were called retrospective amendments. Retrospectivity not from 1 year or 2 years, retrospective from 1961. Now that was what had happened in Vodafone, and that was why. So again, coming back to the discussion of ambulatory and static approach, that is why an ambulatory reading is suggested over a static approach. You cannot go and see the 1995 Act and declare it and check a taxability for a transaction which happens now in UK. You should read the 1995 treaty with the act now, with the present act. So that's how you actually read a treaty and an act, and then look at whichever is beneficial and then apply whatever is the beneficial provision. Okay, so that is on the static and the ambulatory approach. Now the question again, so whichever is more beneficial to the SSE is what I was saying. Now does that mean that the treaty overrides the act? So in a sense what we are saying is that the treaty, we have a provision in the act, we have a provision under the treaty. We can even have a non-obstantive clause in the act, like section 79 has, where all section 79 makes all other provisions redundant under the act. If you see section 79 supersedes some sections, where some will say section 79 will say, some sections will say notwithstanding anything contained in the chapter, that means only that chapter it will supersede whatever. But some sections will say notwithstanding anything contained in the act, that means it supersedes every other provision under the section, right from 1 to whatever 200 300 sections, it will supersede. Some sections supersede that. Now it can, anything can supersede the section, but does it supersede the act? Sorry, can a section supersede a treaty? No. A treaty will always override the act. That is the power which is given in section 90. You cannot look at a treaty, you cannot look at a non-obstantive clause in the act and then say it is taxable based on a non-obstantive. And there are various decisions which has held this, and this is a very settled position. But does it always override? Then again, I'm coming back to the next question. Yes. It will override. Notwithstanding anything contained, then there is another section 2A. But what about this? Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 2. The provisions of section 10 of the act shall apply to the SSE even if such provisions are not beneficial to him. So subsection 2 of chapter 10A is on general anti-avoidance. So what the again, I'm coming back to the provision of collecting taxes, general anti-avoidance of shoring up tax revenue. So the government was saying that the government was saying section 90, the government was saying that, so this is chapter 10. So government was saying that, okay, fine, now everybody is saying act or treaty overrides act. Treaty is saying treaty will have capital gain provisions which are beneficial to the SSE, and then they will take that, they don't pay tax in Mauritius, they don't pay tax in India, and they go scot-free. That was the view which was taken. So then what they did was, okay, sometimes it overrides. I agree, in most cases it overrides, but sometimes it doesn't override. That where it doesn't override is where GAR, it is called the general anti-avoidance rule. So general anti-avoidance rule is where impermissible arrangement. So suppose I go and invest in Mauritius to get a tax advantage of double non-taxation, it will come within the provisions of GAR. So my point which I'm trying to make here is not every time does the treaty override the act. You have to look at the arrangement and then you have to see whether it comes within the provisions of CAR, and if CAR doesn't apply, then treaty will override the act. So that is what it says. Now I have said that you have to look at wherever there is a cross-border payment, you have to look at the act. Not only the act, but you have to look at the treaty. When you look at the treaty, you have to look at the, you should have an ambulatory approach. You will Petronet, coming back to my example of Petronet. I am supposed to look at the treaty, no doubts there. Then the other question is, does the non-resident have the right to access the treaty for this transaction? No. Or in other words, I am obligated to look at the treaty and I am obligated to form an opinion based on looking at the treaty and then determine which is beneficial for me. So treaty is beneficial for me. In my example, I found that treaty is beneficial for the SSE. I am also safe to take the treaty view. Therefore, I will remit the $100,000. Does it end there? No, it doesn't end there. The other question then you should ask yourself is, does the non-resident have right to access the treaty? I am supposed to look at the treaty because section 90 asks me to. I don't need to look at anything else. I should look at section 90. Section 90 is telling that I should go and look at the treaty. I will enter and read the treaty. Treaty is much more beneficial. Then the next question which you should ask is, why should the non-resident access the treaty? Why should I give a provision? Or in other words, what should I get from him so that he can access the benefit of the treaty? So what is that which I should get from my non-resident, which enables me to give that beneficial provision? And what is that which gives him the right to access the treaty between India and US? And that is where a tax residency certificate comes into play. So as a Petronet employee, what I'll do next is, okay, boss, I found out that my treaty provisions are beneficial, but the buck doesn't stop there. Show me you are a tax resident in US. You show me you are a tax paying SSE in US, then I will decide. Otherwise, I will still go with my earlier tax view of deducting 10%. Then what he will do is, he has to go and approach his IRS. Okay. He'll go and approach his IRS and tell that, see, Petronet has asked me to prove that I'm a tax resident. I can show my return of income and all, but that is not sufficient. You have to give me a tax or a certificate in your letterhead which says I am a tax resident in US. That is known as a TRC or a tax residency certificate. Now, a tax residency certificate is the mother document which you should take from that SSE so that I can give him access to the treaty and tell him, see, okay, you have the treaty access, this is there, but you give me the TRC. You prove that you are a tax paying resident in US, then we will look at the remaining. That is where a TRC comes into play. So the tax residency certificate is what is the document which proves that this particular non-resident is a tax resident or a tax paying SSE in that particular jurisdiction. Now, I'm sure here most of the members here would have issued some form of 15 CACB in their regular practice. If you see a 15 CACB, when you do a 15 CB, the 15 CB is very clear. First, there are part A, part B, part C. If part A is the general details of the SSE, then the next two parts of a 15 CB is analyzing what is the position under the act and what is the position under the treaty. Now, whatever is beneficial, you are supposed to adopt. You cannot escape that because that is what the act is giving me. That act itself is telling me. So I have to do that. But assuming that treaty is the beneficial thing, and mostly it will be only treaty which will be beneficial. Act will never be beneficial because the act is drafted in a manner where the domestic country will want to shore up the tax revenue. So an act will never be beneficial. It will always be the treaty. So the treaty will say, now, when you say that the treaty is beneficial, so therefore you are giving a zero withholding, or you are saying, you are certifying that it is only 10% or it is only 5%. How are you saying it's a tax resident? It is the TRC. It is a TRC which will say that it is the TRC which you should collect as a, so charter as a, you should collect from the SSC, from the non-resident, and say, okay, now I have the TRC, now you can go, now I'll issue the form 15 CSEB. But then again, there are some, I think there are some leeways which was given in rule 37BA, right? Where in some circumstances, you don't have to look at the treaty, but you only have to look at the, you don't need to collect a TRC. You only have to get a few documents, a taxpayer identifier number and things like that, where which is enough, which is sufficient documentation to prove that it is 37BC, right? Yeah. Okay, so 206AA. So I look at the tax rate. So again, before going into the treaty, I look at their domestic rate. Okay, now I'm going to, so 206AA again is a non-obstantive clause, which will start with this non-obstantive clause and say, wherever there is a higher rate, wherever you have to look at the domestic rate, and if there is no taxpayer identifier number, if there is no TRC, you have to apply the maximum rate or 20%, whichever is higher. That is what 206AA will say. So suppose SSC cannot get a TRC or any document, there is a relaxation which is provided. And in those cases, you don't need to collect the TRC. You just need to collect these documents, name, email ID, address in the country, a certificate from the government of that country of the law, a certificate of his being a residency certificate, or a taxpayer identifier number. Any of the following details is sufficient. You don't need a TRC basically. If you get the taxpayer identifier number, that is a sufficient document wherever there is no PAN, and where you are going to make payments in the nature of interest, royalty, fee for technical services, dividend is introduced recently. So that is what a TRC. So I hope you have understood the flow. Now, okay, let me just pause here. Any queries? So this subject is such that there can be a lot of counter arguments. Whenever a session happens here, everybody will have their own view, because that is how the subject is. So anything here which you have a different view or a clarification or something which you want me to add before I go into a treaty? Okay. Okay. Now I'm looking at this payment. Okay. Now I'm coming again. I'm coming back to the patron payment. So it can be anything. All these engineering payments, all these software payments, all these fee for technical service payments are the usual payments which come within the purview which we see in practice, frankly. I have not seen much capital gain transactions. I will tell you like what happened in Mauritius, but I will see. You know, this is the treaty between Singapore. Okay. Now let's say let's talk about an example where, I'm making a payment. So I bought some, so Petronet is supplying. So what Petronet is doing is that they are not merely constructing. Okay. What I have agreed with them is that I need a software. So it is not merely the storage tanker, right? There will be a control room where the LNG, this thing is stored, the petroleum is stored, it should be in the app temperature. They should check that there are no leakages, et cetera, et cetera. And all these are from a control. The control room will have its own software. Now, those payments, software payments are usually classified as royalty. Make payments which you make for technical services, for consultancy services, it usually comes under fee for technical services. When you get dividend, you get you are taxed it as dividend. So there are these streams of incomes and payments, and wherever, depending on the stream of payment, you go and refer to article, you refer and you go and refer to that particular article.
Now, article, let's look at the Petronet example itself. Now, what they did was, the agreement which they did was, the agreement, they'll come, they'll tell me how to, they'll give me, they'll show me how to, you should do this. So they have the expertise. I don't have the expertise to construct the storage tanker. They have the expertise. Okay. So they'll come to Cochin. They'll be here. They saw the site. Then they came up with the plan. Then this is how you should construct. And then they went back. Now the question is, this is what this is, they have built for $100,000. So this is an example where it is a technical, it's a consultancy services which they provided. Okay. Now I go, as I was saying earlier, as I was explaining earlier, I go and look at my domestic act. Section 195 will say I am supposed to deduct tax for payment to a non-resident. Nothing for me to explain that. It is straightforward. Now, whether the payment is coming within the definition of fee for technical services, that is the next question. I should not look at 194J here, because 194J and all will not refer to a resident, it only refers to resident payment. So there is no concept of looking of 194J and all here. I look at section 9. I determine if it is taxable under section 9. I go at, I'll go to 115A to determine my tax rate. So fee for technical services, fee for technical services, income by way of section 9 subsection 7, which is 9.1 subsection 7 will say, income for fee for technical services payable by a person who is a resident, who where the fees are payable, except the fees are payable and utilized of business carried on by such person outside India for the purpose of making or earning any income from any source outside India. So do I satisfy this clause? No, because I am a resident and the terminal is coming up in Cochin. So it is for earning income. So it's for a business and profession carried on in India. And the purpose for earning is in India. So everything is in India. The source is in India. Section 9 is entirely on source. It is not on residence. So the source of that income is in India. And the FTS clause is very clear. Now, is it an FTS? That is the next question. You look at explanation 2. Explanation 2 will say, for the purpose of this clause, fee for technical services mean any consideration, including any lump sum consideration. Even if you get it in part payment, you are any, if you're giving payment in installments, or even if you're giving it in lump sum, everything for entering any managerial, technical or consultancy services, including the provision of services of technical or other personnel. So any managerial, technical or consultancy services, irrespective of whether it is engineering contract, everything is covered under FTS. There is an exclusion which is given for construction as X, but does not include construction, assembly, mining or project. Where recipient or consideration would be chargeable under the head salary, not relevant here. We are making payment not to an individual but to Petronet. So the definition of the act is very wide. If I am saying anything, they have given me consultancy services here. So it is very clear. Section 911 is very clear. And I have to, so it is an income, looking at my source of income, looking at the source rule, it is chargeable to tax. I don't have any issues as far the tax, whether as far as this is concerned. Now let me go to the treaty. Sorry, I'm saying US, but I'm looking at Singapore. Sorry, let me just look at the US treaty. It is called fee for included services. Fee for included services. So this is the language in the US. It is not technical services, it is included services. So included services will say, for the purpose of this article, this is the definition. It is the same thing. Technical services, included services are the same. Now you have to see how the language is. You have to look at section. You have looked at the act. You are very clear that it is taxable under the act. Notes two ways about it. It is pure FTS, because anything is covered under that. It's a very expansive definition. It's not a narrow definition. The scope is very expansive. Then Section 90 will say you have to go and look at the treaty, because I'm making payment to a non-resident. Where will you? This is my India-US treaty. What is the nature of payment? It is fee for included services. What is the definition of fee for included services? Fee for included services means payments of any kind to any person in consideration for rendering any technical or consultancy services. Still there, we don't have any second thoughts. If such services are ancillary or subsidiary to the application or enjoyment of right, property and claim for a payment described in paragraph A, etc. make available technical knowledge, experience, skill, know-how or process or consists of the development and transfer of a technical plan or technical, right? So the term which you should look at is make available. So the act didn't have this provision, right? The act was very clear. Did it have a term which said make available? No. Now, what does make available mean? How do you say whether an act, whether a particular payment, whether a particular consultancy has made available? That is the next question. So you should look at whether there is a make available. So now you look at the transfer, you look at the agreement, you go back to the agreement. Now that is the mother document. When you look at whether a transaction is taxable or not, anything should be supported by the agreement. You obviously will read an agreement. Everything should be supported by an SOW and an agreement. Now you look at the agreement, okay. Now, how will you determine whether there is a make available here? So technical services can be provided in two manner. Let's forget international tax now. Let's look at we are chartered accountants, right? And we give services to my clients. I give services to my clients, different kinds of services. Now, suppose I gave an advice, let's say I gave a tax advice on withholding, or let's say I gave a share valuation or something. I collect fees from him. Thus, will my client, because I've done this service, have I made available my services, is the next question. Or in other words, the test of determining whether make available applies is determining whether tomorrow the service which you provided to the client can independently do the services without my help. Coming back to my example on Petronet. So Petronet, US company gave some services to Petronet, right? Now, assuming tomorrow Petronet is again constructing one storage tanker in, let's say, Andhra Pradesh, they found one more site. There also, they have to do the same thing, they have to construct. Now, the question of whether make available applies is, one is already there in Cochin. Can Petronet go and independently, they already know, they saw everything, they have the plans before them, they have all the resources before them, tomorrow if they want, they can employ the manpower also do this. But can they do it is the question. Just because it is there in Cochin, can they go and do it in Andhra Pradesh, the same thing independently without the US companies in or not? If the answer to that question is yes, they can do it, that means the US company has made available their services. That means tomorrow Petronet can independently go and build their own. They don't need a incorporated itself. They can use the same plan. They can use the same designs. They can use whatever they gave for doing it in Cochin to in Andhra. They can just copy paste that. They don't want a itself. That is when make available gets accepted. So in other words, when once make available gets attracted, withholding will apply. That means I am determining that based on my agreement and whatever is my experience in this, after I've had all the discussions, based on whatever clauses are signed, because there will be clauses in my agreement which will say, again, if you have seen agreements which will say, you cannot, A incorporated will have to protect its services, right? They will have to protect whatever knowledge they have transferred, right? So they will say you cannot replicate it, you cannot do this there, you cannot do this without our permission. They will give a lot of restrictions. Suppose the agreement does not have anything of that sort, and Petronet is free to do whatever it wants in the next project, that means there has been a make available. That means the make available test has been satisfied. That means holding will apply. But what happens if make available? So whatever services, again, coming back to the domestic example of we are not making available our services to our client. We are giving services, I'm not denying that. But tomorrow, can the client go and independently do the services? They cannot do it. They don't have the expertise. We have given the service to them. That's it. Next time they want the same services, they have to come back to us. And we have the expertise to give the services. We have not satisfied the make available. Or in other words, if my domestic act, if section 9.1, if here in this definition, there was a make available clause, this particular payment would have not also been taxable under the under the domestic law also, provided the agreement is drafted in that manner. So this is how you go and look at the treaty. This is how the treaty, first of all, this is an example, classic example of how a treaty is drafted and how an act is drafted. The act's language is very vast. Everything and anything will be taxable under the act. You don't need to look at the act even. But it is important to understand how languages are drafted between an act and the treaty, and how the tax show, how the tax allocation is done among the jurisdiction, so that the commercial requirements of both entities are met. So suppose it is not taxable. Suppose there is no withholding tax for me means my obligation to withhold amount pay to the central government for file form 27Q or whatever is gone. At the same time, my obligation to pay is met. US entity is also happy. They get the full amount. They will pay taxes there. India is saying, we don't want your tax. We don't want this be tax. Because again, India has also appreciated the fact that they have come here and given me some services. They came here because of that. We have a container terminal in Cochin. Without that, we couldn't have done, because somewhere we may not have the internal resources. So that is appreciated. And therefore, India has said, let's have a make available clause in the treaty in US. I don't want to tax every single payment which I make to US. Let's see if the make available test is satisfied. If there is make available test is not satisfied, I will not. India has said that you don't need to deduct withholding taxes. But if the make available test is satisfied, then that means you have actually provided genuine services, and therefore US company will be liable. So that is how treaties are drafted and negotiated and agreed and codified. So this is one example. Let's look at another example. Let's look at royalty now. Okay. So these are the usual two streams of payments which will be there in between a resident and a non-resident. Okay. Now royalty is a subject matter of huge litigation. Royalty, especially in terms of software. So whenever you make a payment, so suppose you buy a software, let's take the same thing which we are using in Cisco. Supposing you are making a payment to Cisco, do you have to withhold taxes? Supposing you are making a payment to Microsoft, do you have to withhold taxes? Before I go into software and all, let me just tell you what this royalty actually, what is royalty first of all. Royalty is defined under the Cinematograph Act or something. So there is a definition there. For the actual definition of what royalty should come through. The term royalty, what I meant to say, not the payment stream, term royalty. Now, let's say I go into a bookstore. Okay. I book bookstore report. I'm empty. Famous book under the one person. I bought that book. Now, one person made it. A book made it. Can I go to Mohanlal's house in Tevara and say, see, I have bought empties for one person. Now, let's go and make Randa Muda. Can I do that? Or, in other words, the question I am asking is, I'm trying to ask here is, just because I have the book, there's no doubt there. I have paid the money, I am owning that book. No second thoughts there. But just because I am owning the book, does it mean that I am owning the literary content in that book? I'm owning the book. I'm owning the pages in the book. Everything, what I can do, whatever I can read the book, I can fling it away, I can tear it, I can do whatever the book. Nobody has a right to question me. I can agree, disagree, whatever I can do that book. Nobody. But then the question is, do you own the literary content in that book? If that is the case, then you can just go to his house and then ask him to, then let's proceed with the film, right? You cannot, because the literary content still rests with the publisher and the author. You only own the book. You don't own the right of that book or the content in that book. You don't own the copyrights associated with that book. Somebody had the skill set to think of a story, put it down in paper, publish it, and make it into a book and got accolades. Does that, so who, just because you are buying the book, do you mean you are owning the content in the book? The answer is no. you only own that book, but you don't own the right associated with the literary content of that book. Very simple, very simplistic example. But now let's look at let's extrapolate it to a cross-border payment. Now let me again go back to my Petronet example, because you know that will cover a lot of areas. Now I'm buying, as I said, I need a I've constructed this storage terminal. Okay, there will be a control room, and in that control room there will be monitors. The monitors will control that. There will be a software in that. It will not be Microsoft Office, Windows. It will not be what you see, Adobe and all, nothing. It will be very, very specialized software which is needed to run that particular storage plan. It will not be in the public domain even. It is only for that. Now, there are two types of agreement which can come by. There are two types of agreements which I can enter with my US entity. One is I buy the software. One is I get the software. What I get is merely a license. I don't get the software. I can install it in my systems. I can run the software. I will just install it. I will use the feature associated with that software. So suppose they hire 10 employees for the control room. I again buy 10 licenses and I use whatever they have given me in the software. That is one kind of agreement. Second kind of agreement is, this is a very specialized software. I have to keep on modifying it. I have to add it. I have to customize it to my requirements. As A Incorporated may have done a project, may have done a Cochin project to construct this terminal, but it would have done a different project, let's say in UAE or let's say even in India, which will have a different set of requirements, which will have and there the software which they would have given would be much different than what they gave to the Cochin plant. So the other type of agreement is a software where I, Petronet, is not only using the features associated with the software, but I'm getting the source. What are the contents of that software? What are the features? I want this extra addition. I want this feature for the software. Tomorrow, if there is a bug in the software, I want my people to sit and code. Along with you, I want my people sitting in Cochin to code and find out those bugs and errors and rectify it. So this is a much more customized software where I have not only the right to use the features associated with the software, but also access the rights in that software, access the source of how that software was developed, customize that software to my requirements, and then use it in that manner. And for that, I have an agreement. Now, what is the difference between these two agreements? How will I interpret that in both these cases when I make a payment? That is the next scenario. Now I'm going to make a payment, royalty payment. Okay. Now, this is the act. This is section 9. I'm looking at the act now. I'm not looking at the treaty still. Section 9, explanation 2 defines royalty. Royalty means consideration, including any lump sum consideration. Again, whatever lump sum. For what? For transfer of all or any right, including granting a license in respect of a patent, innovation, model, design, secret formula, process, trademark, etc. Imparting of any information concerning the use of that software, use of any patent, invention, model, design, etc. for that software, imparting any information containing, etc., etc. So transfer of any, all or any, the use of or the right to use any industrial, commercial or scientific equipment, etc. The transfer of all or any rights, including granting a license in respect of any copyright, literary, etc., etc. will also be royalty. And then services rendered into connection with 1, 2, 3, 4 is also royalty. Again, this is a very expensive. In fact, if you go down, computer software means this. They have refined computer software, which was earlier not there. For removal of, again, for computer software, it will say, clarified that the transfer of all right in respect of any right, property or equipment, including and always is included, transfer of all right, all or any right for use or right to use of computer software. So the point is, whatever agreement, whether it is the first scenario or second scenario, anything, even if I take a license, even if I grant a copyright, only a copy, even if I don't grant a copyright, I'm only giving, granting a license, or I grant a copyright, or I, whatever the transaction, whether it is under the first scenario or the second scenario, it will be taxable under the Act. No two ways about it. So under the Act, again, for the software royalty payment, I'm making, I decide that, yes, this is taxable under the India-US treaty. Now let me go to the, under the Act. Now let me go to the India-US treaty. Again, royalty and fee for technical services and fee for included services may also be, so that what it starts with, royalty and fees for included services in the contracting state and paid to a resident of the other contracting state. So India, paid arising in the contracting state, which is arising in India, and paid to a resident of the other contracting state, which is US entity, may be taxed in that other state, which is US. That is what the first clause will say. Fine. But you have to, you cannot stop there. You should go to the second clause. However, such royalties and fees for included services may also be taxed in the contracting state in which they arise and according to the laws of that state. That means according to the laws of that state. But if the beneficial owner of the royalty, of the royalties or fees for included is a resident of the other contracting state, the tax, that means it can be taxable in India also. And at the following rates, at 15% or 20%, at 15%, now everything is 15%, provided it satisfies the definition of royalty. Now, what is royalty? Again, this is a very small definition. Royalties, as used in this article, means payments of any kind received as a consideration for the use of or the right to use any copyright of a literary, artistic, or scientific, for the use of a right to use any copyright of a literary, scientific, art, or scientific work, including cinematograph films or work on film, etc., or other means reproduction, patent, trademark, design, model, plan, secret formula, or information concerning industrial, commercial, scientific, including gains from deriving from alienation of any right, etc., or is royalty. Payment for any kind received as consideration for the use of or right to use any industrial, commercial, or scientific equipment other than payment. Right? Full stop. So you look at the definition between the royalty in India, definition of royalty under the Act, and the definition of royalty under the treaty. The definition of royalty under the Act will say anything and everything is royalty. Whatever you do, you are taking a, you are transferring, or you are just taking a copyright, or you are getting a license, everything is come within the Act. So the under the first scenario and second scenario, both are taxable. The first scenario is where I'm just using, like how you are using Cisco WebEx here. You are, Cisco hasn't customized this based on the requirements of the institute, right? I'm assuming that Cisco, you are using and adding features what you need, and Cisco will give it to you. This is already there in the software. Cisco doesn't have to do anything special to do that. You will say, this is the feature I want, this is the number of licenses I want, please give me the software. That is different from saying that you give me not only the soft right to use the software, but also how you develop the software, because I want, for my business purposes, I want the, how I want the source of that software, the source code associated, because tomorrow, if there is a technical issue, or tomorrow, if I want to replicate this, or tomorrow, if I want to make additional copies, I want access to all that source code so that I can do all that. I can do whatever I want with the software. That is the first, that is the second scenario. Now, both the scenarios are covered under the Act, but the second scenario is not covered under the Act. Again, I'm saying second scenario, but again, you should look at the agreement, because the treaty will restrict royalty only to use, only in a situation where the copyright itself is given. So suppose MT gave you the entire copyright of not only just the book, of not only buying the book, but also he said, no, you take the content also. If you went and spoke to MT and he gave that to you, that is what you have got the right, a copyright to that literary content itself. That means you are in full possession of the entire product. If you have that, that is what is covered under the treaty. In the first scenario for Petronet, that is not covered. It is just, I'm using Cisco, I'm using that software, that's all. But in the second scenario, where I'm using the source code, I need to make changes to that. That is not covered under this, that is typically not covered under this treaty. Now, from my practical experience, so let me share. So one of my clients, they are into water construction of water treatment plants. So what they do is they bid government contracts, state government contracts, and they construct water treatment plants for the government. Not only water treatment plant, but pipeline supply, everything they do. Now, what happened is the contract will be between this India entity and this government, right? But the India entity will also be taking, India entity will not be the standalone owner for doing everything. They will have agreements with entities all over the, especially European entities, which has the technology for this water treatment. Okay. So they were constructing a water treatment plant in Chennai. Now I saw the agreement. This was a scenario where my understanding of royalty was only restricted to all these software agreements. Software agreements where either it will be just a copyright. So let's say there is this software which is used in designing factories or machinery for factories. That is a very specialized software. So people here, Indian manufacturers want access to that software. So there will be resellers in India who interact on behalf of the US entity, and then they will sell the software in India. So all these are, so the agreement, the question was the agreement between the reseller and the US entity, whether it is giving, whether the powers which is granted, whether the payments which are made to the India entity by the Indian entity US will be under royalty. So these are the usual typical contracts which comes to me. And where in most cases we have a lot of where it is a settled position, especially the Supreme Court ruling 2 months back in the case of Engineering Analysis Center of Excellence, which finally settled the matter. Supreme Court, this was a huge issue. Software royalty is a huge issue where because there is a lot of Cisco, even Cisco is there, Dassault, there are a lot of entities who does software, who sell software, Adobe, Microsoft, who can, and they do a lot of software sales in India. And the question was whether these are royalty or not. Supreme Court finally settled that it is not a royalty. So again, this was a subject matter. Again, let me go into a bit of litigation here. This was a subject matter of dispute in lot of high courts. So Delhi High Court, in the case of Infrasoft, there was a decision called Infrasoft, and a lot of decisions, Dassault in Bombay and all, which held that it will not be royalty because I'm not getting a copyright. I'm only using the software. I'm only using the features of the software. The US national hasn't granted me any copyright in that software. So they were really taking favorable positions. But there was a decision by the Karnataka High Court in the case of Samsung, where they said, no, you are getting a copyright. They analyzed the act, they analyzed the treaty, and then they said, no, it is not merely using the features. You are actually being granted a copyright to the software, and therefore it is taxable. So there were conflicting decisions, and because most of the software payments were centralized in Bangalore, Karnataka High Court was against on that issue. And then there was a lot of appeals before the Supreme Court to settle this matter. Finally, Supreme Court said, okay, it is settled. So there are certain, if you read the Supreme Court decision, there are certain categories of SSEs which are mentioned in that. So that is all these usual software payments. Now, coming back to my example, so I was looking at this particular agreement. Okay. Now, that particular agreement was very different from what I had seen. So because that SSE was not only constructing the water treatment plant, to monitor the water, to monitor the purity, to monitor the flow, to monitor leakages, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, you need specialized software. It is not done manually. It is all specialized software. But that software was very different in the sense that it was giving, that SSE was giving the right to the end customer to, they were not selling software. My client was not selling any software, but basically they were giving a lot of source code rights. They were saying, because the nature of that contract is arranged in such a manner that you cannot have a mere copyright sale. You have the customer requires, my customer here is the state government, or even if it's a private player also, see, it requires access to your software. That is when I realized that it is not only the software which they are getting, but the right to the software, the source code of how that was developed, so that it can be customized to the requirements of that, what the plan needs. Sorry, suppose tomorrow there is a defect in that, there is an issue in one of the in one of the construction. It is the software which will highlight it. So that software is highly customized. And what is that? And the software and the water treatment plant which is constructed in Chennai is not what is constructed in Coimbatore or Vaipin or Bangalore or whatever. It is very different, because every plant requires its own customized requires its own customized needs depending on where it is situated and all. So that was a form of contract where, even though there was a royalty and 150 decisions which said, at that point of time, Supreme Court decision was not there because it only came 4 months back. But at that point of time, it was more or less settled that except if you are in Karnataka, if you are in Bangalore, you will have to do a withholding. But if you are in other jurisdictions, whether it was Chennai or whether it was Kerala or whether it was Bombay or Delhi and all, it was same to assume that whatever royalty you are being paid, you don't need to make any withholding. But this contract was very different in the sense that the customer was getting a lot of right access to the features associated with the software. And therefore, it was needed that there the payment cannot be classified as just a restricted payment which didn't give any copyright. There was actual guarantee of copyright there. And that is where we had to debate, we had to look at case laws, we had to look at clauses in the agreement and finally conclude that it is actually taxable. Now, coming to taxability, now these are usually the agreements. So this is a classical agreement, treaty agreement. I was just running through day-to-day practical requirements, and I was also trying to reflect the practical experience which I have, which I wanted to share with you guys also. So the any article will have, any treaty will have article, what are the taxes which are imposed. Now, let's be very clear. So as I said, every country will look at increasing its tax base, right? It's a, in India also, they will look at it, and US will also want taxes. In fact, US is now the major country which is pushing for large tax reforms. As I was saying in my first discussion, Kerala and Tamil Nadu or any state cannot collect taxes. But that is not the situation in the US. In US, the system is very different. There is something called as a federal tax, which is the income tax which we pay. But there is something called as the state tax. That means every state has the right to collect taxes also. So in the sense, every state, let it be New York, let it be California, let it be Texas, let it be Arizona, whatever. Let it be whatever state, that state also has the right to collect taxes. So it is similar to tomorrow Kerala collecting taxes on income. Assuming Kerala, that is the system which US follows. Now suppose somebody is paying both federal and state taxes. So there, I have to anyway pay income tax, federal tax, and I am paying state taxes also, which is anyway I have to pay to the state of the wherever I am located. Can I take credit of both? So this article, if you see, it is referring to only federal taxes. So under the treaty, you cannot look at a state tax payment. You cannot use the treaty to see whether state tax payment is taxable or not, because the treaty doesn't cover that. It will only restrict its discussion to federal taxes. But the other thing is, and this is a tax planning which sometimes can, it's sometimes based on litigation, based on case law which you can take, is it is not a tax. So our 40 subsection small a 2 will say taxes paid cannot be claimed as a deduction, right? You cannot pay a tax and claim it as an expense. You're supposed to disallow it. So there are rulings which says the state tax which you pay in there is not a tax in India. So then even if you're not paying, even if you are not able to take credit, then you should check whether you can allow it as an expenditure. So that is something which you will have to do your research and form a view. There are people who will say you can take the deduction of expenditure, and if you give a deduction like that, you are basically saving the reducing the tax cost basically. So then there are residence condition. Now what I want to discuss is on permanent establishment. So I am looking at royalty and talked about FTS. I will speak on dividend now, but before that, let me look at permanent establishment. So what is permanent establishment? So the term may be a misnomer, but what simply saying what permanent establishment tries to address is whether business income of an SSE is taxable. That means I've been talking about royalty, I've been talking about FDS, I've been talking about other streams of payment. But what about business income, the corporate business profits? For any entity, whether it is a domestic entity, whether it is situated located in India, or suppose an entity which has operations in, let's say, 10 countries, tax is always profit is always one figure. Okay, for me, for my company now, I may have offices all over the globe, but when I look at my taxes, and how it is spread, for me, profit is always one figure. It is not five profits. It is one company profit. I may prepare separate accounts for all this, and there will be separate profits which are being reported based on my reporting disclosures and all. But as far as a company is concerned, profit is always a single figure, and I pay taxes on that profit. Okay. Now, what about business profits? How do you go and tax business profits? So now let's say you take to positions of withholding taxes under royalty or FDS and all. Now, again, a usual question which an assessing officer who will want to tax as much as possible, who will like to bring more and more expenses and income within the tax net, he will look at an arrangement. Okay, fine. You are saying if make available is not satisfied, you are saying copyright is not granted, I am agreeing to all that. Royalty, FDS, nothing is there. Fine. But what about PE? What about permanent establishment? What essentially the US company is doing is they are coming, they have come to Cochin, they are staying there, they are doing all sorts of activities which any normal, if they were a typical Indian company, they are helping in setting, designing, they are helping in construction, they are helping in setting up your software, they are giving you employees to train train your manpower to use all this. They are giving you all sorts of help. Now, why are you saying that whatever income, whatever profits, let's forget streams of payment now, royalty, FDS and all, let's forget. The assessing officer is asking you, whatever they did here, they are going to get a payment. They are going to earn some profit out of this. Why shouldn't I tax the profit at 40%? 40% is the tax rate for the non-resident, right? Unlike a resident, which is taxed at 25 or 30%, depending on what they choose. Assessing officer is going to ask you, whatever discussions, right? You are a very intelligent tax planning guy, fine. But what you did now is, essentially, you did business activities in India. You came to India, you help in construction, you supplied your employees came here, you set up, as if you were operating an office in India, you did that. Why is that India project? Why can't I call the India project as a PE in India, as a permanent establishment in India, and tax everything? Why can't they do that? So that is what a permanent establishment tries to bring into purview. Now, again, here also there is something which you should look at the domestic end. So what is the similar part? Like I have been showing you definitions under the Act, right? Now, for royalty and FTS. So here it is business connection. 911. So under the Act, you have to look at whether a particular non-resident entity has a business connection in India. So typically, practically, nobody looks. Petronet will never look whether US, it is the US company's headache to ensure that there is no PE, frankly. Petronet, as far as Petronet is concerned, I just want my plant fully finished, fully functioning. That's all I need. I want it within the timeline. Whether you are a PE or PE, not PE and all, is your headache. That is not my headache. So I'm not going to look at all that. But again, the question is, whether there is a business connection in India. Should I look at whether there is a business connection in India? And that is where a business connection. So business connection. So the term business connection is defined here. Yeah. Explanation 2 will define business connection. Okay. Now, explanation 2 defines business connection in such a manner that everything is coming, whatever they do, they will fall within the definition of business connection. That means This business connection shall include any business activity carried out through a person who, acting on behalf of the non-resident, has an habitually exercised in India an authority to conclude contracts on behalf of the non-resident or habitually conclude. So that means whether somebody in India is concluding contract, whether he is, so suppose there is a person in India and he is acting, this person, what he does is that he is finding out customers in India for this guy, for the US entity. Now, is he acting on his own accord or is he being controlled by the US? Is he being controlled by the US? Does he have who has the responsibility to conclude the contracts? What kind of contracts is he, what kind of powers does he have? That determines whether that person, whether there is a business connection or not, which is existing. Now, assume there is a business connection which is existing. Assume that mostly the business connection is kind of expensive to. Then what should you do on the treaty? Then you look at PE. So a PE will say place of management, a branch, an office, a factory, a workshop, anything which a US entity is doing. So a branch, suppose a US entity has a branch in India. A branch, mind you, is a non-resident. It is not taxed based on the, if a US entity is having a branch in India, can you call the branch as a resident? No, it is not called a resident. It is a non-resident, but it is taxed based on the source rule, based on business connection. And because of the fact that it has a PE, it satisfies both the conditions. It has a business connection in India. It has a business, it operates a business and it habitually executes contracts, does everything. Plus the treaty itself is saying a branch is a permanent establishment. So a branch is always taxed in India as a foreign company in India. So that is why branch. So, but let's look at other contracts like the installation contract, like what Petronet is doing. Let's say, or let's look at a contract of oil refining. An installation or structure used for exploration or exploiting natural resources, but only if so for a period of more than 120 days. So typically what queries will come from non-resident people is for all these contractors. So let's say ONGC. Okay, ONGC does drilling and exploration, right? They do wells, they will need wells to do that. So the wells, sometimes ONGC has the wells. As those wells, you have seen those advertisements where that big construction is there in the middle of the sea. Sometimes ONGC has the wells, but in most cases there are entities who supplies this. Okay, so then the question which comes from these entities is, what will happen if I give the well? What will happen if I give the well to India? Will I be a PE or not? Simple. Will I be taxed? Leave the payments. I'm not talking about any payment that ONGC makes. I'm talking about from the non-resident company perspective. Just by supplying the oil rig here for exploration, does it satisfy? Does it mean that I have a PE in India and will I be taxed? That is a question. That is a question which comes. So then we look at 120 days. We look at how long a period will be there, and then we'll go back and say, this is what 120 days is, what is the limit? And then there are ways to say how this 120 days should be avoided. But let's look at our Petronet example. Okay, Petronet, if I a US entity, a building site or construction or installation and assembly project, so our supervisory activity. So this is still PE. What is a PE? A PE can be a building site or construction, installation or assembly project or supervisory activity in connection therewith. There are such site project or activities together with other such sites project or activities, if any, continue for a period of more than 120 days in any 12-month period. So that means for 120 days, if it is there, if these activities are carried out in India, that means employees come, they sit in India, they are doing construction activities, building activities. They have, so my A incorporator is not only doing the planning and all, they are buying materials, they are importing materials and they are building it also for me. Cementum, kambiyam, ella avaru medichittu avarenna enika project complete cheyirunga. Then will that become a PE? So that means it will become a PE if it satisfies the 120 days criteria in any 12-month period. That means, let's say they were there for 3 months, activity alone kind of, they go, 90 days. So 90 days is okay, right? And let's say from April to April, May, June, Moonu Masam, it got over construction. But again, they came back, let's say in October, and they were again here for 3 months for some post-construction work, Did it cross the 120 days threshold? Yes, it did cross. So in any 12-month period, it need not be continuous 12-month period. In any 12-month period, if it crosses that threshold, then incorporated is deemed to have a permanent establishment in India, what will happen if there is a permanent establishment in India? It will, whatever profits it earns from its activities will be construed as a business. Therefore, if you look at royalties, if you look at everything other than a permanent establishment, anything which is other than a permanent establishment, royalty will say, if it is, if royalty and FTL, fees for technical services, will say, if it is not connected to a permanent establishment, it will be taxed as royalty or fees. But if it is connected to a permanent establishment, then it will be taxed as business income. So that is what the concept of business in permanent establishment says. No, there are different types of permanent establishment. Common permanent establishment is like, these are all fixed place. So this is essentially called as a fixed place fee. Having a structure here is called fixed place. Then there is this is called construction PE. Then there is called something called as a fixed place PE, where let's take a example of 2017 decision in the case of Formula One. So Formula One decision was a classic case of PE, fixed place PE. What happened was that, you know, the time is 12:10. No, okay. Ranjit, I have time till 12:30 or 12:45, is it? Are you there?
1 o'clock, sir.
Okay, 1 o'clock. Perfect. I'm audible, right? Or is my connection okay?
Very, very clear.
Okay, fine, thanks. So then the Formula One. So the concept of Formula One is, what happened was that, you know Formula One, right? So people here would be following Formula One races. One year, Formula One happened in Delhi. Both international circuit in Delhi. So you cannot chuma do a Formula One racing by constructing a stadium. Even if you have the infrastructure, what happens is you have to approach Formula One. It's a UK entity. What they do is that they give the rights. There is a systemized way to how to conduct a Formula One. First, they have to give you the rights to use the Formula One label. Then they have their own specific condition of how the track should be, how many cars should be there, etc. A lot of conditions. Okay, and Formula One gave the right to JP Constructions to the Formula One racing. Have the Formula One event in India. They had the Formula One event in India also. Now the question was, this is a Formula One event, okay. And the stadium is not owned by F1 Federation and all. It is owned by India entity, JP. The question before the Supreme Court was whether that Formula One event, which happened in Delhi, does that result in a permanent establishment for Formula One UK in India? Mind you, it is not owning any assets. It is not owning the racetrack. They gave a lot of permissions to use the road, to use the brand name. They wanted it. They have specifics of how to conduct the racing. They did it according to that. The question was whether there is a PE in India. So how the issue came up was, so because of these rights which was given by Formula One, this JP had to make a lot of payments to UK entity. So they went and approached what is known as an AAA, Advance Authority for Advance Ruling. Now that comes under international tax, settlement procedures. So there are different ways to know tax certainty, because ultimately these are high value contracts, right? So tax is a major cost here. So Formula One will want to know from India entity, will there be first of all withholding, or whether there be taxability, what is the tax cost out of all this? Formula One will know, and Formula One would want to minimize the tax to the largest extent. So what JP did was, there is a mechanism called as AAR, Authority for Advance Ruling, which is similar to what is there in GST, where you approach, you go and ask the department before entering into the, before executing the payment or making the payment or whatever, you go and ask the department itself, you tell me whether this is taxable. This is the facts of the my case. You look at the facts and you tell me, I believe this should be the tax question. Either it should be taxed at 0 rate or 5% or whatever. But you tell me what is your view. AAR will look at it. And what happened in Formula One's case is that they gave a negative order. AAR gave a negative ruling. They said that it was all taxable as royalty and FTS and all. What they did was, once this AAR came, they went and filed a writ before the High Court. Or I think the Supreme Court, writ cannot be filed before Supreme Court, High Court. Delhi High Court gave a negative ruling against SSC. They said, this is actually not even royalty. You should not look at it, classify it as simply a royalty. You should look at it as a PE. Because look at what SMC is doing. They have the premises at their disposal. They have, it is as if they are conducting, a race here in India. They are doing everything in India. They may not have an office presence or they may not have an entity in India. And all. I agree, but look at the nature of the agreement. Look at the clauses in the agreement you have entered into. There is a fixed place which is at disposal for the Formula One, for Formula One India, for Formula One UK in India through this stadium and track which they have given. So this is a fixed place. This went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court also affirmed the High Court's ruling. So what was that? So to determine whether there was a fixed place, there are several tests. So one is called as the disposal test. So they found out that the disposal test was satisfied. Why is this disposal test? What it actually what it actually means is that this particular premises is always at the disposal. There not be any ownership rights and all. It is as if Formula One UK has a mirror entity in India through this stadium and the race track. Therefore, whatever income you earn from doing this race and all will be taxable as a you should not look at it from the lens of royalty or FTS. You should look at it from a PE perspective and tax all the profits. So this was a landmark judgment which came. So if you read the Supreme Court ruling, which is 300 pages, if my memory is right, it has a detailed explanation of why it satisfied the disposal test, what are the different tests which was carried out to determine whether there was a fixed place PE and why. So that is what permanent establishment is. Permanent establishment is basically trying to say that you cannot merely look at it from, okay, I saw the individual streams of payment, royalty, FTS, whatever, I agree there. And you have said that it is not taxable as FTS because there is no make available. You cannot tax as a royalty because there is no copyright given. Fine. But look at what the entity did as a whole. Look at the entire arrangement as a whole. Look at what, let's look at our definition of what Petronet did. Look at what that A Incorporated did. They came here. They had premises at their disposal. They did everything here. They supplied their equipment, they supplied their know-how, they basically practically did business in India. So that means why can't I tax the profits which is arising? So that is the discussion around permanent establishment. So permanent establishment is not only by fixed. So that is, there is fixed PE and fixed place PE and construction PE. But there is also service PE, which is called employees. And there is agency PE for having agencies in India. So what employee PE will basically is secondment. So I don't know whether you're familiar with secondment or arrangement. So what happens is US entity. Let's look at, we have a number of techno parkilum, sorry, info parkilum, there are all captives. Captives is basically, they are, manpower is in India, cost plus markup, cost plus markup to the US entity and US entity gives some money. So basically it is managed out of US. But there is a shareholding, they are a 100% subsidiary. It's typical captive. Now what happens, now assuming that, so let's assume that one entity in InfoPower is running in losses, is being mismanaged and what. So what the US company, what the US head office decides is, they will send employees from US. They want to revamp their organization as a whole. So what they decided to do is, let's bring employees there. Let's bring my own employees. And for bringing employees, it is not free, right? So you cannot expect the US employee to pay a continuously pay a salary and the India entity to enjoy the benefit of a free service. That will not happen. What will happen is, typically what arrangement will happen is, once the people comes here, is they will enter into what is known as a secondment arrangement. So under the secondment arrangement, what will happen is, the US, they have, so like we have PFs here, they will have their own security service. They will have their own benefits which are given there, social, what the name, A401k and all, which is called in US. That will continue to be there. The US entity will continue to pay those benefits here. They may or may not be paying, they will be paying, assume that they will be paying salary for the employee. But what the Indian entity should do is that Indian entity will reimburse the salary cost which is being paid by US to the employee who has come to India. Not only that, they will arrange, the secondment arrangement will be done in such a manner that US may be an economic employer. That means they may be paying salary, but it is not the actual employer. That means they will cut their relationship with the employee just for by the arrangement to say that this person is acting on behalf, is not acting on behalf of me. Agreed, he's come to India to revamp my India entity. That is no doubt there. But he is an independent person. It is as if he is employed by the India entity only. Therefore, now why is those accountment arrangements entered into is because services, activities. So in some article, some service fee is there. Okay, so in some treaties, what happens is because of paucity of time, I'll just explain it to you. What happens is, if an employee of an entity comes in India, especially, okay, why should I go into all that example? COVID. What happened after COVID was, people became stuck. You employees, people who used to work in Dubai, if they came to for holiday or into their home in India, they became stuck when the first wave came. People who are in actually works in US but came to India, they became stuck here. Okay. They became stuck because they are not in, they couldn't fly back. So then the issue which actually employees, foreign companies started asking is, now if you look at some treaties, it will say if this employee sits here for more than 120 days, just like this 120 days, 90 days, it is as if that employee is a PE of the US entity in India, and whatever income, whatever they earn out of whatever that employee does, whatever income they earn out of that activity which the employee does, that will be attributable from US to India and therefore taxed in India. That is what service PE essentially means. So when COVID happened, what happened was that people were stuck. So people were stuck, they couldn't fly back. So they will not satisfy the conditions for, they will not only become residents, but they will not satisfy the conditions for not becoming a service PE. They may not have had secondment arrangements or not. Then government had come out with notifications then and even now, which says that if the limit does not cross the specified days, if they will not be as if it will not result in a PE. There were discussion with OECD. India is yet to take a position on that, but they came up with some relaxation in terms of period of stay. My point is, a PE can also be created not only by having a fixed place or an office or a branch. It can even be created by a few employees sitting in India, doing activities on behalf of US, earning income in India, not only by through salary, but through other means. They are earning income which is directly being given to US, which is not being taxed in US. Assessing officer and say, see, whatever these employees are doing in India, it's attributable. The source is still in India. While you can talk about all while you can talk about whatever in terms of royalty, FTS, it is because of these employees' activities you are able to earn that income. So this employee sitting here forms a PE. It is, which is ideally called as a service PE, and therefore it will be taxed. So whatever profits you earn, A incorporated on from the activities of those employees will be chargeable, will be construed as a PE, and therefore the business profits will be taxed in India. Then there is agency PE, where dependent agents, when you do agency services, you know, you have to look at the agreements where the stock is maintained, et cetera, et cetera. It will be classified as a permanent establishment. Now let me go to another issue which is there, which when you look at treaty, let's look at what is known as an MFN clause. Okay, so there is something which is known as a most favored nation. Okay, let me take the France treaty. Now under the US, now what is happening is that suppose there is a French company, okay, and there is a subsidiary in India. Now the subsidiary in India had some profits, okay. Now what they are going to do is they are going to declare dividend. Now the dividend declared earlier, DDT had to be paid and all. Now there is no more DDT here, okay. So it is taxable in the hands of the shareholder, which you may already know. That's an amendment in the Domestic Act. 115O is no longer applicable. Now the question is, when the India entity pays dividend to the France holding entity, what is the withholding somebody has approached you. So then you will look at that act. The act will give its own rate, 30% foreign entity. But you will anyway look at Section 90. Section 90 will say beneficial rate should be applied. You will look at the India-France treaty. Now, India-France treaty, this is the dividend. Article 11 talks on dividend. Dividend paid by a company which is a resident of a contracting state, India, to a resident of the other contracting state, France, may be taxed in that other contracting state, which is France. That is what the first thing. You cannot full stop, but you cannot stop there. Second. However, such dividend may be also be taxed in the contracting state of which the company paying the dividend is a resident, and according to the laws of that contracting state, which is India, if the recipient is the beneficial owner of the dividend, that means he is my 100% subsidiary, he is my holding company, so he is the beneficial owner of the dividend, then the tax so charged shall not exceed 10% of the gross amount of dividend. Fine. So the act is giving a higher rate, treaty is giving a lower rate. Can I conclude that it is at 10% as a next question? No, I can conclude it, fine. But is there another tax planning involved here? Is there a possibility for another tax planning? No, that is where a concept of most favored nation is given. Now, what an MFN clause basically means is, so it's MFN clause are signatories of an OECD, of OECD countries. What they decided was, okay, now again, see, it is very difficult to go and amend a treaty, correct? In the sense, you can amend an act. You can just pass a finance bill in the Lok Sabha, get presidential assent, and the act is amended. But can you just amend a treaty by passing an act in the parliament? You cannot do that. Central government has delegated the powers to make treaty, but the treaty is not a one-sided document. You have to sit with the other party, discuss and then agree on the taxing right, and then only the treaty is final. You cannot simply unilaterally you cannot go and amend a treaty. So because what was happening is, now there is a dividend which was saying 10%. Now let's say India has another agreement with Colombia, okay, another country, Colombia. Now in Colombia, the dividend, if had the Indian entity being a subsidiary of Colombia, the dividend rate would have been only 5%. Now the question is, here it is 10%. It is very clear. It is anyway 10%. There is not. Can I import the 5% rate to the India-France treaty? That is the question. Can I do that without doing any? This is not treaty shopping. This is not anything. This is just, can I import that 5% into my India-France treaty? Yes, you can, and that is why there is something known as a protocol. So it doesn't end there. You should look at a protocol. So these are the protocols here. Okay, these are all amendments which has come in the treaty, and these are generally called protocols. So the protocol for dividend, so this is what is known as a protocol. So again, this is a protocol is incorporated into the treaty after both countries agree to it. It is not unilateral, it is bilateral. So in this protocol, if you look at point 7, okay, in respect of Article 11, dividend, etc., if under any convention, agreement or protocol signed after 1999, that means this agreement was signed in 1899, between India and a third state, which is a member of the OECD, it should be a member of OECD, India limits its taxation at source on dividend, interest and royalty, FTS or payments for use of equipment to a rate lower or a scope more restricted than the rate of scope provided for in this convention at that of the said items of income. That means it is either the rate or the scope. Now, I have already shown you how the scope of a definition as per the treaty is much more restricted than the scope as per the act. That I have already shown. Now, suppose there is a treaty, suppose India-France, there is a scope as per the India-France treaty, right? Now, suppose India has a treaty with another entity which is a member of OECD, there the rate of scope, there the scope is of the definition is even much more restricted, or the rate is even lower, you can go ahead and apply that rate here. That means country A, country B, country C. Country A and country B, India, France. India, France has said there is an MFN clause. There is a protocol which says if the rate is scope is restricted or the rate is restricted between a third country, not with an agreement with a third country which is part of this OECD. Which is part of this OECD, then whatever you are agreed with that third country, with A, between A and C, with India and let's say Colombia, you can import that rate here. That is what both the countries have agreed. Now let's look at treaty, let's say Colombia. Okay, same dividend article. Here it is 10, there it was, I think, about 13. Again, the same clause starts. Dividend paid by a company which is a resident of a contracting state to a resident of the other contracting state may be taxed in that other state. Okay. However, such dividend may also be taxed in the contracting state of which the company paying the dividend is a resident and according to the laws of that state. But if the same language, but if the beneficial owner of the dividend is a resident of the other state, the tax so charged shall not exceed 5% of the gross amount. So there, in the India-France treaty, you saw 10% rate. In the India-Colombia rate, you saw it is 5%. India-France has an MFN clause, which says if you agree with an OECD country for a restricted rate or a restricted scope, you can import that benefit to the India-France treaty. Is Colombia OECD is an approved country? Yes, Colombia is. Can I go ahead and give this 5% rate? Yes. Therefore, when you look at when the SSE, so this was a subject matter. So again, what I'm referring to is actually a case law. If you read Concentric Services, Netherlands BV, it discusses this aspect on, and then there is Sanofi Pasteur, there are other cases, but Concentrica is a 2 months back decision. It came in, I think, May. What Concentric said was, again, it is Netherlands, actually. That was not France, that was Netherlands. The Netherlands entity was receiving dividends from its India subsidiary. Now, India subsidiary was again looking at what is the tax rate. They saw that the tax rate is 10%. Netherlands also is same as France, it is 10%. Then they saw Colombia. Okay. In Colombia, it was 5%, which is this treaty. What they did was they went and submitted an application under 197. They didn't do an AAR because AAR is a very costly affair. It is a time consuming process. It will take 2 or 3 years for a decision to even, not even 3 years, it will take more than that. So they went and filed them. So for such transactions, they went and signed a 197. Sorry, they went and applied for a 197. So the 197, the assessing officer said all this. Then he said, okay, nothing doing. I am ready to give you the treaty right. You can talk about your MFN and all, but your treaty is saying 10%. I'm not going to look at the MFN. Why I'm not going to look at the MFN is what his contention was, this India-France was in 1989. Okay. This was, this, I think Colombia came sometime much later. So when it was notified, you didn't have this rate. Then you should have gone ahead and negotiated a lower rate. So then this was a subject matter of dispute. Subsequently, I think it was a Delhi High Court assembly which said that the SSE is eligible for the reduced dividend rate of 5% because the MFN clause was there, because the MFN clause was granting a benefit which is a lower, which is because India, Netherlands, just like India, France, I was showing the France treaty, but Netherlands also has the same MFN. And because the MFN is prevalent and because Colombia or Slovenia, there are other countries which is also part of OECD, you can impute that rate into this. So finally, the SSE won the case and they were eligible for a 5% rate. Now, this is all about treaty reading. So that is how this complication, or what I should say, the cross-border litigation is very prevalent, is because of the difference in interpretation and the fact that every SSE. So why did India agree to have a protocol like this? Because they wanted more entities to set shop in India. Correct. They wanted more investors to come. They will say, look, dividend is only taxable at 10%. There is even an MFN which will give you. They will not project all this, but you will have to read and you get it. But so this is a bilateral agreement which is agreed between India and France. Why can't you give this benefit? You can give this benefit. And that was what the ruling in Concentric held. So that is on dividends. So I covered government establishment, royalty, FTS, dividend. So these are the major things. Then I've covered MFN. Then there is something called as limitation of benefit, which is known as LOB. What LOB basically says is, it's the opposite of MFN. You cannot give, treaty itself says is, okay, there is a benefit above, but you cannot go and access it. That is called LOB. So the LOB in Mauritius, which will say, you cannot access if you are a, Singapore will say, if you are a shell company, you can't have been access the benefit of, and there is a definition for a shell company in the Singapore treaty. Capital, assuming capital gain is exempt in Singapore, okay, let's say it is exempt, and up till 2007, all investments are grandfathered. So Singapore will say investment till 2017 is grandfathered, and therefore it is exempt. Capital gain is not, is there. Taxing right is given to Singapore, not India, and therefore Singapore, anyway, domestic act, they don't have capital gain, so it is exempt. This is what Flipkart decision, Flipkart used Singapore road, and then it went into a lot of litigation, and finally they had to pay withholding tax. Anyway, that you can read Flipkart at a later point of time. The acquisition of Walmart by Flipkart. Sorry, acquisition of Flipkart by Walmart. Now what Singapore treaty will say is that it will define what a shell company is. Okay. Now there is something benefit which I projected to you earlier on UK. It is there in Singapore also. But Singapore has something known as an LOB. What the LOB basically says is that if you are a shell company, you cannot go and access the treaty for capital gain because you are a shell company. You are coming within the definition of a shell company. That means your only objective is to prevent, is to avoid taxes, to do treaty shopping. And the shell company is looking, how are you calling it as a shell company? There is no substance. Basically, you just incorporated the company, had some expenses and kept it there. You're not booking any income. You're not carrying out any business activities in Singapore. You are just trying to make use of the benefit which is there in Singapore treaty and the domestic act. And you're just trying to do a treaty shopping. So Singapore will say, because you are a shell company, though you have an exemption for dividend under the treaty, you are not entitled because it is limited. So that is known as a limitation of benefit clause. So MFN, similarly, just like there are MFN clauses where you can go and access a third treaty and get the beneficial rate, within treaties, there is something called LOBs, which restricts the scope of even the treaty much further if you satisfy certain conditions. So that is known as LOB. Now, before I go into transfer pricing, so let me speak to you about some developments. I have, let's say, 15 minutes before, 10 minutes max before I open the floor for any questions. So as I was saying earlier, what happened was US entities, especially US has a lot of MNCs, right? These Apple, the Microsoft, Salesforce, companies like Shell, etc., who are basically US entities, okay, Starbucks, etc. What they were finding was these are $1 billion conglomerates. But what US was realizing it, what they were realizing is even though they are earning billions and billions of dollars in revenue, they are not getting any taxes from them. Amazon. They are literally paying 0.0.0.0.0 percentage of taxes or even zero taxes in the US. Now, then I go back to my first discussion where any country in the world will want to look at increasing its tax base. It's very simple. Every country wants to increase taxes, but they don't want to increase taxes by increasing tax rates, which is a last resort. They want to shore up their tax revenue. So what US found out was that they are in a very disadvantageous position. The IRS is saying that, look, you have become $1 billion companies by having a US address. You are supposed to be US company, but you are not contributing to any taxes here. Why is that? Then they went and investigated the structure of these companies. So that is when they found that all these companies have genuine structures. They are not doing any tax manipulation. There's no manipulation here. I'm not talking in terms of doing a manipulation or a tax avoidance. They have read through all the treaties under which US has signed with various countries. They found which treaty is worded more beneficial. They have, let's say Google, okay, Google search. It's a very powerful tool. And there is a code for that. That tool is not just a website. There is a source code for that. So they have gone and patented that in Ireland. Apple has patented its products in the iPhones and the Macs and all has patented it in Ireland. Why? Because Ireland was a country which gave where countries could, where a country, where a company could go approach these Ireland government and say, see, I'm ready to set up shop in your company, in your country. What is the benefit you will give me? And Ireland will say, okay, you don't think whatever intangibles you have, you put it in Ireland, don't put it in US, because I know in US has a royalty, they will charge high. So you put it in US, all the royalty, whatever you get from these payments from any country, anyway, we have agreements with most countries and which are favorable agreements. You park all your all your intangibles here. And between US and Ireland, anyway, there is an agreement, but the withholding is very little or zero. You use that. So they found that countries like Ireland were being used for avoiding or for reducing their tax burden. I wouldn't use the term avoiding, for reducing their tax cost, because as a company, they earn such billions and billions of dollars, tax is a major cost. So they will be looking at how I can reduce my tax liability. So they will look at these arrangements and then they will form agreements with them. Then US suddenly woke up, UK woke up, France woke up, Germany woke up and then said, this cannot go on much longer. We will have to start negotiating the treaties. We have to start changing the treaties now. This cannot go. But then there was a difficulty now. US had to sit with Ireland, you had to sit with France, Germany. Every single country had to come to the table and sit, and they had to have some 100 representatives and they had to negotiate, which is a time consuming process. And again, the country will have to agree, because every country will want to protect their tax base. So again, the other country, US cannot say that this is what you should sign. They cannot do that. They have to get the other country sign off also. Other country will say, no, this is working for me. I don't want any changes. I don't know why you're asking for so many changes. I don't want to do it. Because India, let's say they are engaging in a conversation. India will say, no, we cannot do any changes. This is fine for me as it is now. So then they said, this will not do. So what the developed countries then did, they formed what is known as an MLI, which is known as a multilateral instrument. So people who are studying international tax now, which is very relevant. What they said, what MLI basically says is that, so it is a master document. Okay. Instead of me going with all countries sitting in the table and discussing, let's have a framework. Let's take one document. Let's prepare one document with a lot of sections, with a lot of provisions. Some sections are non-negotiable. Every country will have to accept. Some section, most of the other sections, let them choose whatever they want, let them choose. And let us agree. Let's not sit on the table individually with each countries and negotiate and agree on a rate and scope and all. We will form a document. And that is what is now known as a multilateral instrument. So a multilateral instrument is addendum, you could, like what you saw as a protocol, is an addendum to the treaty. Now, going forward, so India has now a multilateral instruments with a lot of countries, France, Australia, and all. So what, now when you read the treaty, you should read it along with the MLI also. So, and there are changes in some clauses which has changed the taxing right and all. Now MLI is what, so I told you, that there is a huge hue and cry. So this is an offshoot. What they came up with some action plans, which is known as base erosion and profit shifting. Those the term for eroding the profit base, like what I was giving the Ireland example, is known as BEPS, base erosion and profit shifting. So they were shifting. Apple was shifting profits. Google was shifting profits. Amazon was shifting profits to other jurisdictions. So, and they were eroding their tax base. Countries, you developed countries, were not getting their fair share of taxes. So that was why they came up with action plans. There are 13 or 15 action plans, and those action plans are more tuned to the current requirement. Because now, let's say you travel in an Uber or an Uber today in Cochin, you will note that, I don't know how the system is now, but sometime 1 or 2 years back, you will note that if you see the invoice, if you do search your invoice for in your email, you will see that the Uber invoice is not an Indian entity. It will come from Netherlands, Uber BV. You have literally paid not Uber India, but Uber BV. Yeah, why? Because you use the app has some features. The features came from a specific code. That code is now patented in the Netherlands. Therefore, you are paying the Netherlands entity. Now, what India did know? So India was very smart in that way. So they quickly saw an opportunity here. Again, India wants to look, shore up the tax revenue. So India found out, look at, they saw those action plans. Then they saw digital action plan, one is on digital economy. So then they saw that these payments, no, these intangible payments, let us, so Google, now you do and go and type Google, let's say you type Amazon, you wanted to search for something, let's say shoes. You search shoes means you show results. You show search results, but on top of that, there are AdWords, right? You click on that AdWord, you go to the site. So the AdWords are revenue. So once somebody goes and clicks in an AdWord, there is a revenue generation which happens to Google because somebody clicked in that AdWord. Now what India is saying, Google has an office in India and Bangalore, but all these arrangements are not, India is separate from India, Google is India separate from what they do in US. So what they thought, no, let's input some, let's to increase the tax revenue, let's import some concepts like equalization levy. Equalization levy basically says whenever you make a payment, let's say for ad services, and if support, it can be even LinkedIn or whatever, and if it exceeds specified threshold limits, let's say 1 lakh, there is a levy which should be paid to the India government, and that is known as equalization levy. Mind you, it is not a tax, it does not come under the Income Tax Act. There are in two budgets, Finance Act 16, Finance Act 20, equalization levy first came into 2016, then it was updated with in a 2020 version. In both the acts, it didn't come under the Income Tax Act. While it is a tax on the payment, it is similar to all the royalty FTAs which we have been discussing. It is a levy which intelligently the India government made it under the Finance Act, similar to service tax, erstwhile service tax, which never had a separate act. It was under Finance Act. Equalization levy is also under the Finance Act. So by putting it under the Finance Act, the advantage was that Section 90, where is Section 90 in the play? There is no Section 90, because if you need to go and access Section 90, it should be under the Income Tax, right? It should be a payment or something under the Income Tax, right? It is here, they are not even calling it as a tax, they are calling it as a levy. So what they did was that they gave it, put it under the Finance Act, and right now, so equalization levy was first introduced in 2016, then it got updated in 2020, where advertising revenue, not only advertising revenue, but e-commerce sales, suppose Amazon Incorporated is earning some income from Amazon India for making some big billion day sale and all happens, right? Whatever income comes here, if any payment is made by India to Amazon India to Amazon US, all those are coming within the purview. So there is no profit here. Gone are the days where they are looking at profit. How do you attribute the? That is only time consuming and litigative. So what the Indian government basically did is introduce equalization levy in 2016, one of the first countries to do it, because the BEPS action plan came in 2014 or 15 only. Immediately they saw an opportunity, and then they did levied this equalization levy. So that is one of the offshoots of the BEPS. That is an update that is part of international tax. The point here to be noted is that is how that cross-border payments have changed from looking at merely the treaty and the act. Equalization levy, where is the treaty? If you in whatever treaties I showed you, are we talking about equalization levy? No, you cannot go, and Google cannot go and access the India-US treaty, go and say it is not FTS or royalty or PE, nothing. It is all levy. That is because it is coming under the Finance Act, and only something which is coming within the purview of the Income Tax Act can access the treaty. So that is another example of how revenue, of how it is increased. So that is one. Then another update is on transfer pricing. So in transfer pricing, transfer pricing is not fully cross-border payment. While it was international tax, transfer pricing is basically ensuring that it's not every payment which is being made at arm's length. So basically, the contract which you enter into with the third party and a contract which you enter into an AG should be the same in terms of conditions and pricing. if there is a pricing change, if it is within the, if it is exceeds the arm's length percentile margins and all, that amount will have to be added back. So, but why, that is one part of transfer pricing. Other part is on other arrangements of repatriating funds. So what they were seeing is some companies, what they were doing is they were under arranged, rather than make payments in profits and profits and all. What the department was observing is, and again, this was an offshoot of action plan only, was that there were a lot of loans which are being extended by the AE entity. US parent is extending loan to India entity, and India entity is making payments to for interest. Now, what they saw is that this interest expenditure is a huge expenditure, right? So then what they said was that, what the India government basically said was that, in the Income Tax Act, they amended again in 2017, and they came up with Section 94. Yeah. Limitation of interest reduction. So this is again an offshoot of equalization, offshoot of BEPS action plan. What it basically means is, if you are making any payment in the form of interest to your AE, you cannot claim the entire amount as a deduction here in India. Okay, rather you restrict it to a percentage. You look at your profits. You would look at, I think, 5% of the profits. Excess interest. I think it is 3%. Interest means amount of total interest paid or payable in excess of 30% of the EBITDA. Okay, so you look at your EBITDA, you take 30% of that. So let's say 100,000, 1 lakh is your EBITDA, 30% is 30,000. So you can look at 30,000, let's say your interest payment is to your AE is 50,000. You cannot claim your entire 50,000. You have to restrict it to 30%, 30,000. Remaining 20,000, you spread it over a period of 8 years. So this is another way where India was trying to, basically, they thought that all these interest payments were adding to the cost burden of lower taxes, and they were making a lot of payments to US, to foreign AEs in terms of, and this is between AEs, mind you. This is not third. This, if you are taking it from a bank, this doesn't apply. If you are taking it from an ECB from a bank, this doesn't apply. From an AE, when you take and you pay interest payments, they were saying this is an entire expenditure. Everything is done. Assume that withholding is also done. From an India entity perspective, it was a huge cost. So what the department said is, you don't claim the full amount. We'll restrict it, and then you spread it out. So that is equalization levy. Okay, sum and substance, let me just, now it is 12:55. I'll just conclude my discussion now. So international tax is all about balancing your domestic payments with your cross-border, with your domestic law and your cross-border law. How are you going to balance? So international law is drafted in a manner where each country, each respective countries in a transaction protect, get their fair share of revenue without eroding their tax base. Any cross-border payment, you have to first look at the act, see what the position under the act. If it is a payment which falls under the Income Tax Act, you get your TRC from a non-resident, or if it is, you get the relevant documents which is given under 234BC, you go and access the treaty. In the treaty, you see the corresponding provision or payment. You look at the agreement. What is the clauses in the agreement? Is it a, if it is a royalty payment, is there a copyright being granted? If there is consultancy services, is there a make available being, is the nature of the service given in a manner where make available will get attracted? You look at all that, and finally you will conclude whether, which is the beneficial. There is a rate under the act, there is a rate under the treaty. Whichever is beneficial, you give it to the SSE, you give that benefit, and you close the transaction. Then other point is where there is a levy. So when you read the treaty, you should read it very holistically. You should look at the definition under the act. What is where is the scope restricted? Okay, the scope is usually restricted in the DTA, fine. Now, is there an MFN? Go down, look at the protocol. Is there an MFN clause? Is there a lower benefit which I can give? Is there a possibility to do that? Okay, if there is an MFN clause, there is an MFN clause. Go to the respective treaty, which is an OECD country. See whether there is a possibility to give a reduced rate. If there is there, make an interpretation, make a sound judgment, and then give or not give the benefit. I had an opportunity to work in a huge transaction, multi-million-dollar transaction for a large software company. And they were using the Mauritius route. So all capital gain transfer, India entity has sold some shares, and the US entity was saying that it is all tax exempt, and they are right. Because Mauritius, it was through Mauritius, and Mauritius, there was no capital gains. It was pre 2017 and everything was right. But the quantum of that transaction was some 10,000 crores. It was huge. It is the largest share sale which I had seen at that point of time. So then the question was, now that is where tax morality comes into play, which is a separate discussion altogether. Do you issue? So the question again is, the client came to us for Form 15 CACB. Frankly, that was a job. It was not to interpret or do any tax advice. It was whether you can see issue. They had all the law was in their favor. And what that company said was right. It is entirely tax exempt. There is no doubt there under the act, under the treaty. But then the question was whether you should go and issue a Form 15 CACB for such a huge amount. But because look at the quantum, look at the materiality of what is being eroded. Finally, we have to say that we will not be able to give this 15 CACB, and they got ultimately from 50. This became litigated before Madras High Court. Thankfully, because the Madras High Court had the same remarks which we did, saying that look at the quantum of the transaction. While you can say that all this, all the tax treaties and all that complied with, you should also look at the fair share of revenue which India should get, because ultimately you are, and it was an India company. And finally, it went against the SEC and before Madras High Court, and now it is lying, I think, before the Supreme Court or something. So again, those are judgments which usually comes in, and then we have to take all those calls. So I have taken up at least 2.5 hours of your time. Today is a Saturday. For some of us, it is working. For some of us, it is a holiday. I only hope that whatever time you have spent first half of Saturday, I have been able to make it a little bit productive. I hope were able to get some sense of what I was communicating with you guys. I don't have anything further to add, sir. You can, the mic is all yours now. Anything, questions, you can ask now. Ranjit, Joe, sir, whoever.
Yes, I'm just checking the Q&A box.
Sorry, I didn't see the Q&A box. Is there questions there?
No, but no questions so far. It is empty only. No questions. So far, there are no questions.
How do I expand this one?
It's on the right side, chat box and Q&A box is there. Yes, so there are no questions from participants. Maybe they can post if any questions, they can post in the Q&A box. At the same time, Parmeshwarji, can I ask you one question? It's regarding international taxation.
Please, sir.
This ESOP, now there are certain ESOPs given by Indian companies, foreign companies, and foreign companies to Indian companies also. So suppose a holding company in India giving ESOP for employees of subsidiaries in US, whether that entire expense can be shown in India or it shall be, you know, transferred to US subsidiary.
You are saying, so I just to confirm the facts, I have an India entity, and India entity, yes, has subsidiaries outside India. India entity has ESOPs which is given to its foreign employees, and your question is whether I can claim the expense here in India.
Indian entity is the holding company.
Yeah, understood. The question you are asking is whether I can claim the expense, ESOP related expense. So basically, yes, the vesting period, whatever you write off during, whatever you expense of during, yes, the vesting period. And yes, it is, I am assuming here it is not exercised.
Not exercised. It is the expense. Maybe it's exercised also later.
Yes, it will be exercised. So when you exercise it, it will be a perquisite in the hands, but and then you will have to buy back. That's a different thing. But you can, so the decision, so you can claim the expense over the vesting period, because the concept is that it is actually an employee cost. You are giving the employees the ESOPs, and it is part of your payroll cost in itself. while it can be an accounting entry, it is a benefit which you have given to your employee. So the decision, if you can refer to the special bench decision in Sutherland, I think it is Sutherland, Bangalore ITAT, I guess. My memory is right. Which has confirmed this particular scenario where you can claim the ESOP as an expenditure over the vesting period.
Even for the non-resident employees, the subsidiaries.
Okay.
Thank you. And I'm just checking, no more questions. And what about the POEM, this management in India now, nowadays?
Place of effective management. Thank you for highlighting that, sir. So again, POEM is an offshoot of residency concept. So again, as I was explaining earlier, Indian entity, Indian company is only considered as a resident in India, right? So earlier there was, in the US, there was something called a CFC, Controlled Foreign Company Rules, which is not part from Controlled Foreign Corporations, which is not there in India. But instead of that, what they were basically saying is, let's, your entity may be a foreign entity. I agree. Your incorporation is India and it cannot be classified as an entity under section 218 or whatever. But where is the effective management? What is the place of effective management? So I'm just opening the act here, 1 second. So 6.3 will say, where the place of effective management in that year is in India. So the place of effective management is where the key managerial decisions are taken. So that is what. But subsequently, there were certain rules which were laid down. What POEM basically imputes is, while you may have, so every entity will have to do a, which has subsidiaries outside India, in your case, whatever you have mention, every subsidiary will do a POEM test. Now the POEM test is about determining if there is an active business in India or a passive business in India. So the POEM regulations will say you have to check whether there is an active business in India, and there are certain criteria which is laid down. There are certain tests. If the entity is doing, while it is a non-resident entity as from a purview of incorporation, if the active business, ABOI, active business, if the entity conducts active business in India, subject to fulfillment of their conditions, then it is considered that the effective management is in India, respective of your incorporation. So it is similar to a business connection. It is similar to the business connection concept, where rather than looking at the source rule, let's look at residential. So let me just rephrase. Business connection is what you will look at from a source perspective, because again, you are looking at whether the source is taxed, business profits is taxed, you look at B. But what then the government did was they introduced residence concept in for foreign companies, and that is how POEM came into the picture. So POEM basically says that, assuming your, okay, let's say in US you have a subsidiary, but your major decisions, you conduct board meetings, you do everything out of India, your CEO is sitting out of India, you just have two marketing employees sitting out there, your company is incorporated here, but but you don't have anything there, your employees are just, you know, entry level employees, they are not even middle level management, they work as per your directions, you are effectively controlling the operations in India, means that entity can be controlled, can be considered to have a resident in India, and subsequently they will be considered as an India company. Ultimately, it will become an India entity, and whatever provisions apply to an India entity, like section, you know, tax audit, like 40A disallowance, etc., will have to be looked at. And that is what, and it is essentially saying that the effective management, place of effective management is in India. So that is one more way where rather than looking at the source, the extent they the section is amended to include residence also in that, to construe residency aspect also for a foreign company.
So that in that case, they have to file income tax in both the countries.
There are certain rules. There are a lot of FAQs which have been issued in this. So first of all, POEM will apply only if you have if you exceed the specified limit. So that I think the section limit is some
5 million. 5 million in this.
So if the
15 crores. 15 crores.
Yeah, 15 crores specified limit. Once that specified limit is crossed, yeah, then it is as if all regulations is there. And yes, you will have to file an income tax return in India. You will have to do audit in India. But again, sir, some relaxations have been given. Maybe I can check that.
No, now the issue I'll tell you. See, these directives of subsidiary are here because of the COVID
situation.
They cannot travel. So by you know by this this by this time one year the directives were in India only. Normally that. Usually they are the non-resident only, they stay in US. But now whether this will be applicable, this POEM will be applicable.
No, POEM, you have to look at it not from an individual perspective, from a company perspective. So POEM, even if the individuals are here, residential status and all from an individuals will not determine it. Now the question is whether you are actively, so that is where relaxations were given by the circular. There was a circular which was issued last year, saying that POEM and all will not apply in certain scenarios and all. I can maybe check that and get back to you, sir. But what I essentially understand is that POEM will not apply because the COVID, because of the COVID scenario where people had to, because of reasons beyond their control, our COVID and Nikandi Bandha. So I don't think POEM will apply there, but I can check this and get back to you, sir.
Yes,
I think there's a question somebody has given, sir. Some consultancy, I'm not able to see the question. Is social proportionate? Okay, consultancy payment made to UAE company. You cannot unmute and speak. Whoever put this, is it possible? No, they don't have the right, is it?
Raju, can you unmute?
Consultancy payment made to UAE company by an India company where treaty with UAE does not remain but only business profits. Yes, in that case, it can be treated as business profits in India. What will happen if UAE has a PE in India or not? Yeah, so you are saying where the provision itself is absent, right? So it's a good question. So what the position which is usually taken is, so suppose I saw you were saying that fee for technical services, the clause itself is not there. What will do you do? India will have a clause which has fee for technical services. Treaty does not have a clause. What will you do? So treaty again is a negotiated document. If the fee for technical services is an exclusion, then that means it is a purposeful exclusion. It is not a omission which is made because they forgot to do it. So the interpretation, there is decisions also which support, which says that if the clause itself is not prevalent, you can take the view that it is not taxable there. UAE is not giving the India will anyway not have the taxing right. UAE also will not UAE also does not want its share of taxes, and therefore no withholding will apply. In fact, there are decisions which has supported that view also. I hope I have answered that query. I hope that was the query. I'm sorry, I'm not able to read it properly. It's very James Cooty Anthony. Okay, so now it's better. Sorry. Consultancy payment. I think Suresh Babu sir had asked. Then there are certain treaties where consultancy charges, can it be treated that business profit and deduct TDS? So business profit, sir, you will have to look at PE, whether they satisfy the PE clause. Just because the FTS clause is not there, you cannot go and impute that it is business. So you should see whether the definition under business profits is also satisfied. If it is not, see, if if the stream of payment is only FTS, and if the clause itself is absent, it is as if it is not, it is a purposeful omission because the taxing right itself is not needed by UAE. Therefore, you don't have to look at the you can take no withholding tax position. You don't have to go back to a PE clause and say 40%, because depending on the structure of that arrangement, it is most likely that they may not have a PE in India. How can it be the overseas company does not have any PE for not deducting TTS? So you cannot see again, the concept of having a PE does not rest with me. Okay. Again, it is a risk which it you if you are in my practical cases, nobody will like to agree that they have a PE in India, because a PE is as if saying that you are actually concluding that you have business in India, you're doing business in India. You may have only gotten a payment stream from India, but when you say it is a PE, you have actually told that you are earning business, and therefore business profits means it will be taxed at 40%. In my wherever I have come across, nobody has agreed for a 40% gross up. Okay, the foreign company will not agree for a 40% reduction. So 100,000, if I have to agree, if I have to pay, they will not say, okay, you give me $60,000. They will not say. They will only say, if you want to deduct tax at 40%, that is your call. If you are calling as a PE, that is your call, but you better gross up and do it. So that is what the cost will be borne by the Indian entity. You don't have to, there is no documentation to substantiate PE. PE is based on facts. Basis the facts of the arrangement, basis the kind of nature of transaction which the foreign entity enters into with India. Is there a PE? Is there a business connection? First is a business connection. Before we go into PE, you should see a business connection. If business connection is not satisfied, then PE also will not likely to be satisfied wherever that, except for that 120 days criterion. So you cannot go and prove a PE. You will have to see the stream of payment, and then you should check the overall activities. If you can check the overall activities, if they are willing to share that. But if you can, if you cannot have that information, then there is no way to declare that you are a PE. Because frankly, you are not the judge to say the PE. The PE has to come, the discussion has to come from the assessing officer. Except if it is a branch and all. If it's a branch, if it's a factory, like whatever. If it's a branch, means a PE, 40%. You don't have to do anything. Suppose an individual is having 1% company in UAE and he is in India for 3 months. In that case, will POEM be applicable in this case? If so, should he offer proportionate income in India? Suppose an 1% company. 1% company is actually a corporate entity, so it's similar to a company only. And he is there for 3 days. And in the case, will POEM applicable? Yeah, POEM could apply, because it is effectively saying that it is applicable in India. But then you have to see the POEM guidelines. You should see whether the threshold limit is crossed. It doesn't cross for everything. And then you have to see it, like servicing 15 crores. If all that is satisfied, yes, and this is a good case to say that it is, there is POEM in India. But again, you can look at PE also. You should look at the PE clause, because again, POEM and business connection is still coming from the act. Then you can should again go into the treaty. The treaty does not recognize a POEM concept, actually. It will only recognize a PE concept. So you should look at whether there is a PE. Can we release a payment without TDS if there is no make available clause in the agreement with the foreign party? So that means you are saying that the clause does not have make available. So if the definition is similar to the India treaty, India Act, then you will most likely will have to take the deduct taxes or take the cost. Otherwise, again, you can look at whether there is a MFN clause. If that particular treaty has an MFN clause, most of the treaties have an MFN clause now. If that particular treaty has an MFN clause, then you can import the treaty which has a make available clause, and then take a no withholding tax position also. That is also possible. I hope I have answered Chako's, James Putti's, and Suresh Babu sir's queries and all. I'm not able to communicate, so I don't know whether I've been able to do it.
Yes, sir. There is no more questions. I hope we can conclude. Thank you very much, Parmeshwar and sir. It was a wonderful learning session for all of us here, because you are going in very, very detail in various provisions in treaties as well as the international taxation, what is very much applicable to, if who is dealing with the international taxation. It is a very, very good session. We could I'm sure all the participants would benefit from this. Thank you very much for joining us on this Saturday morning and spending your precious time. Thank you very much. And I also thank all the participants for joining us on this International Taxation Seminar. And I thank our chairman and all the MC members who joined today for this program. And I have a few announcements. We have lined up a few more programs and in the coming weeks. And for 20th September, we have a virtual CPA seminar on decoding cryptocurrency and its way forward for our members. The speaker will be CA Devika S. And this is the afternoon program, 3 p.m. to 6 p.m., 3 hours CPA program. And 28th September, we have another program, Tackle Transfer Pricing. The speaker, CA Manu KT Balachandran from Kochi, will be joining us. That's also from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. And 25th September, we have another CPA seminar on recent amendments in TDS provisions and its practical issues. That is a Saturday. The timing will be 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. And our speaker for that session will be CA Prachi Parekh from Mumbai, will be joining us. This is the program lined up for next week. And once again, I thank all of you. And I also thank our office staff who is coordinating our the technical assistance for us for conducting this virtual seminar, Raju as well as Stacy. Thank you very much once again. Thank you, permission, sir. We'll meet again. We may, once this COVID pandemic settles, we will have a physical meeting also.
Sir, thank you of all the office bearers. Thank you especially Ranjit for this. It's again, there is an art law institute like a honor. So thank you for this.
And
you are a wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.